This podcast is brought to you by Patreon.com/TalkingSimpsons. Head there to check out exclusive podcasts like Talking Futurama, Talk King of the Hill, the What a Cartoon Movie podcast, and tons more.
I heartily endorse this event or product.
Ahoy, hoy, everybody, and welcome to Talking Simpsons, the podcast that features bold predictions about Willie Nelson. I'm your host, the emotionally shattered babysitter, Bob Mackey, and this is our chronological exploration of The Simpsons. Who else is here with me today in the same room?
Officer Henry Gilbert, calling all cars, come out with your hands up.
And who do we have on the line?
I'm Brendan James, and the only thing going on this podcast is a lot of male bonding.
It's true, and this week's episode is Bart the Murderer.
I don't know how to break this to you, but Principal Skinner is missing.
Uh-oh. This week's episode originally aired on October 10th, 1991, and as always, Henry will tell us what happened on this mythical day in real world history.
Oh boy, Bobby. Both Anita Hill and Clarence Thomas are interviewed in the Capitol. Red Fox passes away on the set of his TV show, The Royal Family. And The Fisher King is number one at the box office.
Red Fox famously passing away from a heart attack when that was his shtick.
Yes, yeah. It's a classic Hollywood story that he's on the show. No one remembers the show. It's the Royal Family is only known as the show Red Fox died on, but it was during the first season of it. He has a heart attack, as famously known. Red Fox's bit in Sanford and Son was that he always pretended, I'm coming, Elizabeth. That was his whole shtick. And people, if you do that your entire career and you eventually do have a heart attack, people will think you're joking. And I would bet if they didn't think he was joking, he probably wouldn't have survived it anyway.
Mm-hmm,
but
yeah.
it's a kind of tragic comic ending to the life of a very famous comedian. And the show was on Fox. It was on the same network as Simpsons as well.
It wasn't part of the Simpsons Drexel's Class block. I think Rock snuck in there too at the end.
Yes, yeah. Drexel Class Rock said
Did you just say Drexel's Class Rocks, Henry? I don't think so.
No, I don't. I disagree with that. And yes, the whole Clarence Thomas thing still going on. I think in between air dates of this episode and the next one, Clarence Thomas is confirmed. And boy, he's still having fun to this day in the old Supreme Court, that guy.
You know, it really brought the topic of sexual harassment into pop culture, and there's been a lot of bad sitcom episodes based on that topic around this time.
Yeah.
And The Simpsons will do one.
The Simpsons will do one. Homer Badman is a really great episode, except for in all the ways it gets sexual harassment entirely wrong.
Yeah.
Like, in so many other ways, it's great. But the Homer Badman stance that a woman misunderstands something and thus she is wrong and needs to be told by a man that, like, you just misunderstood what I did. Like, yeah, yeah.
Give harassers the benefit of the doubt. Exactly. It could be a fun joke. Brendan.
Was that a direct response to the Clarence Thomas stuff, that episode?
Well, it was just that I see it as not directly to that, but I mean, the Clarence Thomas thing catapulted even more discussion of sexual harassment in the workplace. And so,
yeah, there were, it just brought the idea into the world. I remember the famous PSA, that's sexual harassment and I don't have to take it.
Yeah, that's a classic.
That's a Mystery Science Theater recurring line.
Absolutely. I mean, it was hilarious. Uh-huh. A woman being harassed.
This woman is standing up for herself? What a comedic concept.
When we stopped laughing at the old woman falling down, we had to laugh at another commercial, and that was the next one.
And yeah, The Fisher King, it rules. I love that movie, you know? It's so great. Like, I mean, Robin Williams is just so great in it, and it's, you know, it. Sadly, I think his character, who is suffering from, you know, mental illness, and it hurts more watching it now after his passing, I think. But
also, sadly, I love that movie too, but I think of it a lot because it's an example of an Oscar curse for Mercedes Rule, who I believe won the Oscar for Best Supporting Actress in that film.
Right.
And she never really was in anything again. I think the most high profile thing she was in was Frasier. For season three, she was Frasier's love interest in a kind of the weakest part of season three.
Right.
So So, you know, the likes of Cuba Gooding Jr. and Adrian Brody, and I put Mercedes Rule in there. Fisher King.
I'd say Halle Berry as well, too. Yeah, she's
oh, yeah, Halle Berry, yeah.
But, well, and also the actor, I should just look up his name, but the drag queen homeless guy in it, he is the greatest. Like, I love him. The song he sings of that is so great. Like, he is just a funny, funny guy. And then he went on Evening Shade, the Burt Reynolds series.
Speaking of Frasier, I didn't know David Hyde Pierce was in this movie.
Oh, right.
I haven't seen it. I'm sorry.
He's the scumbag agent for Jeff Bridges's character. Yeah.
I completely forgot about that. So that's two Frasier connections. Right. What else is in that movie, I wonder?
And Michael Jeter is the actor I'm thinking of, and he's great. By the way, man, the cast of Evening Shade, Ossie Davis, Hal Holbrook, Michael Jeter, Charles Durning. What a cast. Man, Mary Lou Henner, Ann Widgeworth. Like, yeah, boy, Evening Shade. We should be doing a podcast on Evening Shade here.
I don't want to turn this into too much of a rolling reference fest, but Hal Holbrook also famously, in The Sopranos in season 6, there's a Hal Holbrook cameo, which connects to the episode we're talking about today.
That's right. Yeah, man. There wouldn't, just like this episode of Simpsons, I don't think would exist without Martin Scorsese's Goodfellas. There wouldn't be a Sopranos at all without Martin Scorsese's
yes.
Goodfellas.
Now, that's my first question, actually, because this is good that I have questions, because, you know, last time it was my first time on with you guys and I was so negative because it was a season 12 episode or whatever. And I kind of had to lighten up a bit and I got more into the flow. But this time I have an equal and opposite problem, because this is just a wonderful classic episode. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if I have anything to say except how much I love the jokes and it's very funny. But I have a question first, which is I didn't do a ton of research. I did listen to the commentary because I have the DVDs. You know, a lot of this is very Goodfellas, but I think someone says on the commentary they wrote it before Goodfellas came out or before they even saw Goodfellas. Was this released before Goodfellas or after it or at the same time exactly?
I also listened to the commentary, and I think that was Al Jean being tongue-in-cheek.
Think Al Jean's full of crap there.
Joking,
yeah.
No, it was him joking about, like, oh, could they sue us or whatever. I don't think he was trying to claim that they invented Goodfellas or anything. Yeah. But
Goodfellas came out in 90.
Yeah, right. September 90, so 13 months before this episode, the perfect amount of time to produce an episode of The Simpsons.
And what's interesting about this was definitely written like a few months after the movie came out. And it's interesting to see that they didn't jump on the same memes everyone else did. Like, it's astounding that in this episode that there is no Joe Pesci style character.
Yeah.
Dan Castellaneta is doing Joe Pesci's voice for Louie, but there is no, like, am I a clown? Do I amuse you? Like, everyone jumped on that. There was Animaniacs sketch based on that was what Jim Brewer's Joe Pesci character did on SNL. Like, it's funny to see what they jumped on in this, and one of them is lampooning a guy in the movie who no one really caricatures, and that's Paul Cicero. That's Fat Tony.
Yeah. Although I will say, apparently from listening to the commentary, there's a character, he's a mainstay in the mob, you know, in Fat Tony's gang after this episode. He's got the kind of big curly hair. He looks to me, I always thought that was a Goodfellas character they were doing. I think his name is Carmine in the movie.
Oh, yes. We got a story
okay.
on that.
Okay, because they said in the commentary that was supposed to look like Joe Pesci. And to me, and I think a lot of people, it doesn't really look like Joe Pesci. It looks like that guy from Goodfellas with the big hair.
Absolutely.
I don't know if that was a misremembered anecdote.
No.
Really meant the other guy.
You're correct. Okay. But we should properly introduce our guest here.
Yeah, joining us once again is Brendan James of the Blowback Podcast. And Brendan, don't feel bad about being slightly negative on your first appearance, because everyone needs to go through their modern Simpsons therapy with us first as a first-time guest. Everybody does it, and we're cool with it.
It was Primal Scream therapy. That I'm opened up now. I everything's out. I'm at peace.
I think the next season of Blowback it's been announced at the time of this recording. It's coming soon, and I mean the Cuba season and all the extras were great.
Thank you.
It's unfortunate how current events sometimes line up with the releases of your podcast. I'm a little worried about this season 3, I gotta say.
Well, I think you know, this will probably be the season where we jump the shark. This is our, this will be our season 10-9, the end of the golden era, much like The Simpsons. We had, you know, I was snarky last time, but it's hard to make something good for that long, so maybe I should watch what I say. No, we're excited for season 3, and yes, I think by the time this comes out, we'll still be working on it. We have more ambitions this season. I don't want to hype it up too much, but it's going to take a little longer, but hopefully it's worth it, and it's about the Korean War. And if you liked seasons 1 or 2, or if you've never heard of the show, by all means, stay tuned for season 3.
I said it last time, but season 1 is especially a great listen. At a time when people talk about what defines a war crime and what invasions are, I think it's a good mm-hmm. time to listen back to Blowback season 1, I think.
I hate that this is the thing we make and enjoy doing is tied up in so many negative emotions for people and real world negative things, but I guess you just play the cards you're dealt.
Hey, you're great at it, Brandon. You and Noah are great. Are great.
Thank you. But I have to say, it's nice to take a break and simply pod about The Simpsons and Fat Tony right now.
Well, and what do you feel about mafia movies? Are you a big mafia movie fanboy? Mafia television? I mean, I know you love The Sopranos.
Yes, I was just on another show called Pod Yourself a Gun, which is a fun show about The Sopranos. I think that's what gave us the idea to do this one. You guys, and yeah, I don't know if I'm encyclopedic, but I've seen a lot of gangster movies. I love the genre. I get a lot of the gags that I think the real heads are supposed to get in this episode, for example. And yeah, I was actually going to say Joe Mantegna's one of his earlier movies. Maybe we can talk about him in a little bit. But House of Games is a really stars him. It's a David Mamet movie. It's one of my favorite gangster movies, or at least, you know, criminal kind of con artist movies. And it actually stars Joe Mantegna. So this is a good intersection as an episode to a lot of stuff.
Yeah, you know, but Brandon, have you ever considered that mafia movies could be like a metaphor for like America?
I gotta stop production on season 3 right now and consider this heavily. We used a lot of Sopranos clips, particularly in season 1 of Blowback, because sometimes there's just nothing better than to let Polly Walnuts articulate something that, you know, doesn't need to be spelled out in real terms.
One of my favorite bits, and I just did a full rewatch of Sopranos, and as much as Simpsons, it is so of its time, and I just love, like, just little moments, like when Tony is on a vacation and he's watching just some random TV show that says, well, terrorists could come in through the ports and that would be bad, then later in the episode he's like, and I heard this story about they caught a bunch of terrorists at the ports, and yep. One of his friends says, like, well, thank God they caught him, right? But yeah, that's like
I think to your point, it's of its time in the best way possible, you know, like the golden era Simpsons is, because I think it's quite impressive how much distance they seem to have when writing all, especially the war on terror stuff. It really doesn't plug into anything that they weren't drinking the Kool-Aid. You know, it was pretty dispassionate and well written from the moment that season 3 goes into the 9/11 stuff. And I think it stands up quite well rewatching it, especially mm-hmm. because that subculture, that Italian-American subculture of the mafia, was a really fascinating group to look at during that time, because they were uber patriotic and had always been uber patriotic despite their daily grind and every single cent that they ever made coming from being on the run from the government, trying to defraud the government, possibly killing people related or working for the government. That was like compartmentalized in a way. And I think there's an episode where Christopher says after 9/11, you know, listen to the president, we're going to, you know, mop up the whole world and everything's going to be under our control, you know, as if there's this it's perfectly symmetrical in their minds that they can be crooks every day running away from the government but support the United States government unequivocally at all times. It's and they nail that really well mm-hmm. in those later seasons.
The Goodfellas is I think like one of the most perfect movie.
Good movie.
Yes, you're right. Oh,
you said it.
And those fellas, they're not so good, folks. You gotta watch the movie to find out.
I could re-watch it a million times. Last night, I didn't have, you know, 2.5 hours free to rewatch the whole thing, but I at least wanted to watch everything of Kid Henry Hill, because that is a lot of this episode, or at least Act 2. And And so, and then after it was over, I was like, man, I could just stay up till one and watch it. I didn't, but it's such a rewatchable movie. Like every movie, like it's so many movies ripped it off. It almost seems cliche now, but
it still holds up. Yeah.
Absolutely. It's the ultimate, I know people don't surf channels anymore, but if it's on TV playing, even if it's censored or whatever, you just stop and you keep it on because it's like a big warm blanket you can pull over yourself.
Well, two funny things that I really noticed while watching this episode. One is that they never really returned to the Goodfellas well. They weren't that interested because you think, look, after Goodfellas, Godfather parodies and references go away. No, absolutely not. There's like four in seasons 3 and 4 I can think of just offhand. Fat Tony does not come back until season 6 with Homie the Clown. And the following year, they do another Scorsese movie parody, and that's Cape Fear. And there's more beat-for-beat stuff in that. They're not doing beat-for-beat stuff. Maybe they weren't as confident. Maybe they thought people wouldn't recognize certain references in this. But I was surprised by how little actual Goodfellas material is in this movie. And sorry, in the show.
Yeah, you know, in the Cape Fear one, they definitely were having senioritis, and they're like, you know what, we don't care. But this is the start of season 3 and the start of the Gene and Reese run. So I think they were a little more cautious of like, well, let's not reference, this movie's brand new and everybody likes it right now. But if you get too specific, you're going to lose the audience.
That's much to the episode's benefit as well. I even in the golden era, I think it's always better when they take something as inspiration and then make their own jokes and plot twists rather than, I'm not crazy when they're just doing Sideshow Bob as Robert De Niro in Fear. There's a lot of great gags, don't get me wrong, but I think this is a stronger way for them to parody stuff, is to just take off the first little bit. You get the cute little One Fine Day montage, and then it becomes its own thing.
What I also think is funny from the behind the scenes is like, yeah, I don't believe Al Jean when he says they didn't really base this on Goodfellas. And
he was joking. It was a joke.
Well, no one laughs, though. I feel like an idiot for bringing that up. But like, normally when someone says something sardonic, everyone laughs. But like, there's no, it didn't come off like a gag when he said
it. Right.
But
yeah, he said it kind of flat. You're right.
Yeah, it's like a dry, it's very dry in that case.
He wasn't claiming they invented the idea of Goodfellas. I mean, it was a book in 1985 this.
Well, then, but Rich Moore, like, is very clear that he was doing Goodfellas. And there are shots in this, they're like, well, that's a shot from Goodfellas. They're like, this is paced like one. I think from looking at it, though, they also, like, didn't have the VHS yet. They didn't have the double VHS box of Goodfellas. I'm just going to steal a thought I saw on Twitter from somebody. But that's how movies are longer now, I think, because you don't have to sell two VHSs to sell a long movie now. Like, a movie can be 3 hours on streaming or on a Blu-ray, and it doesn't cost more production-wise to resell it. I think that's why another reason movies are very long now.
I should have probably gotten this in earlier when we were talking directly about Goodfellas, but I will say this is a confession. When I first saw, like, I watched that movie like 50 times at least when I was in high school, and you know, viewing 51, that I realized, this is so embarrassing, but when they're kids, the portion you're talking about that's connected to this episode, I did not realize that the kid Henry's, you know, starting crimes with is a young Joe Pesci.
Right.
Yeah. He's got that slick back hair. It was so, I thought that Pesci was supposed to be a little bit older. Then watching it, it is slightly comical that kid is like this little, like, you know, mini me Joe Pesci that almost takes me out of the film in, you know, in the best way possible because it's entertaining. Yeah. I just can't believe I didn't realize that. And watching it again, I don't know, maybe everyone else knew it, but if anyone watches this after this episode, try not to laugh when you see this little kid like dressed and who talks exactly like Joe Pesci, but like an octave higher show up in the beginning of the film. It caught me off guard.
If only they had the Irishman technology then, they could have just de-aged him to a 12-year-old for that.
That's what they should do before he really fully retires. Give me like Joe Pesci and then like Benjamin Button him into a gangster infant and see what we can get out of that.
One other thing I noticed is that Bart seems to have more of like Spider's job than good old Hank Hill. He's just serving drinks, but he has a much better faith than Spider did.
Yeah.
Although I was pitching rehearsing jokes in my head. Like, I want to see Milhouse as the spider character that gets murdered by Fat Tony.
Did you call him Hank Hill intentionally?
I did. Yes.
Okay.
I mean, Henry Hill, Hank Hill.
That's
I need jokes explained to me. The Al Jean thing was just the beginning here.
Hey, he didn't deliver that joke very well. So you're both. It's fair that you both assumed it was the truth.
You know what's so funny in Sopranos? Every time they mention Goodfellas, like that they reference Goodfellas in the world of Sopranos, I'm like, don't any of you people like say like, hey, you look just like Spider Christopher. You ever notice that? You look just like that actor.
And also, it's Goodfellas, by the way. Since we're talking little gangster movie shop, I don't know what you guys feel. I always vastly preferred it to the Godfather movies. The Godfather movies are impeccably made. I'm not being too contrarian about it, but I remember the first time I saw them, I had seen Goodfellas first, and I found the Godfather movies, again, not talking about craft, but just on a, you know, personal level, it was all very sort of gaudy and the aristocratic angle of these dynasties in the mafia. There's parts where you go back in time in part two with De Niro, you know, as a young man, but it didn't have that grit and that excitement that Goodfellas had, where you're seeing it from the schlubs at the bottom. Was and I think The Sopranos kind of balanced that well, where Tony is technically a boss, but he's a sort of a Jersey, as Phil Leotardo says, you know, dismissively of the Jersey crew, that they're not a real crew as far as the New Yorkers are concerned. So Sopranos and Goodfellas always captured my attention more than The Godfather,
I of course love both Godfather Part 1 and 2. I mean, I think they're great, great films. And you know what? I'm kind of different. I think Godfather Part 2 is better than Godfather 1. But anyway, I do think the, you know, the Goodfellas like kind of just it explodes the genre so much, and it is hard to go back after you see such a deconstruction of it about how, like, right. Godfather is it's kind of about the royal family of a mafia, and it's like the kings fighting each other, while meanwhile Goodfellas is just, you know, a guy who's not even made in the parlance, like he's not that high level of a dude, just telling you all the secrets of like, hey, these guys, they swear all the time, we murder somebody over nothing, everyone's lying to your face all the time, they'll all stab you in the back, that's what the mafia is like. It's just a series of lies and head games to you, like that's what I like more. And then an unfortunate thing for every Scorsese film, which is about toxic masculinity and how awful these collections are, the collection of men are, and how brutal they are to each other. Unfortunately, that goes over the heads of some people who just see it as like, yeah, this is about how awesome it is to be in the mob, and I wish I was in that
mob. I just think they got too drunk before the end of the movie and forgot how it ended.
Yes.
Like, they're all happy and rich, right? Banging broads.
And then they talk about on the commentary of this episode that apparently they were battling with the network or censors for a second because the censors were worried that showing Bart join the mafia might give kids a bad influence, i.e. making them go and, I guess, join the Italian mafia if they felt like it.
Join a violence gang, as Marge would say. No, I think, but I definitely think that sounded like one of the usual pearl-clutching of censors from a very racially motivated standpoint, because as Gene put it on the commentary, they thought it was Bart is joining the Crips or the Bloods, like as in a modern gang full of scary inner city types.
Sure.
Yeah,
sure,
but they let him make drinks.
Yeah, but that's fine. Oh, but if he was, you know, if you replace that Manhattan with a malt beverage, I think they'd it'd be coded a little differently and the censors wouldn't like it. I guess one last preamble thing I have on this one is just that I think a really interesting mix on this is you have Goodfellas as obvious starting point, but a lot of other mafia movies. But you have Goodfellas, which is this deconstruction of the mafia movie by Martin Scorsese, who had not done a true mafia movie for like 20 years of his career. And here he's finally doing one. And then you have John Swartzwelder, who his vision of mafiosos are from like 1938 films. Like that's the mafia guys he wants to write about. And so you have like his classicism meet meets the parody of a meta commentary on mafia films, and I think it leads really interesting places.
It's like a role reversal where, you know, the Simpsons are supposed to be the ones parodying it, but Schwarzwalder, he even said Montaigne wasn't his first choice, or on the commentary they say he wanted the name escapes me right now, but at like a somewhat now obscure 50s classic gangster actor.
Yeah, it was actually Sheldon Leonard, best known as Nick the Bartender from It's a Wonderful Life. Out you pixies go!
And
another thing. Where do you get off calling me Nick? Yeah,
exactly. But he died in 97, and you know, Fat Tony would not have come back after the late 90s then.
That's the dangers of casting the elderly and stuff.
And Joe Montana, Pitch Perfect, one of the best extended universe characters, and like I said before, he's been in a lot of great movies. He's directed a lot of plays as well, some of Mamet's stuff. He's a real, you know, career working guy. Again, House of Games, if you're not a Montaniac.
I like it.
Yeah, and I came out so effortlessly too. Just go look up House of Games. It's a really great movie where he plays a con man who meets Lindsay Krause, who's like a very high-strung psychologist who wants to eventually play things a little dangerous, and she falls into his scene, and he's really excellent, and not in the kind of funny pure parody way that he is as Fat Tony.
And I said this about our first production season 3 episode, Mr. Lisa Goes to Washington, and I feel it even more in this one, that this is, we really loved season 2 when we redid it, but this is a level up. Like, this is, like, they adapt more to the guests that they like, especially Phil Hartman. They know Phil Hartman's good at this, write this into this episode. And also, I think James L. Brooks is busy with his movie now. Sam Simon's kind of gone too, or he's less in power. It's Gene and Reese, and so I don't think James L. Brooks is around as much to say, but focus this back on the family, because this is a crazy ass third act that it builds to.
It's such a different kind of flavor than what aired even towards the end of season 2. It's like they're firing on all cylinders now.
Yeah, I mean, compare this to When Flanders Failed. Like,
oh my God, yeah.
It's a different series, like, almost. Yep.
The Simpsons will be right back.
At last they're here! New Butterfinger ice cream bars.
Hi, dudes.
Crispity crunch at the outside, creamy ice cream inside.
Nobody better lay a finger on my Butterfinger.
As far back as I can remember, I always wanted to be a podcaster, and I welcome you all to this week's break for Talking Simpsons. A big thank you to our guest, Brandon James, for coming on again. We really enjoy his stuff. Listen to Blowback. It is a great political history podcast, and it was so awesome to talk about mafia movies and The Simpsons with Brandon. And if you enjoy this week's podcast, you should know that, as always, Talking Simpsons is brought to you by the wonderful subscribers at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons, because without those subscribers, me and Bob couldn't do this as our full-time real jobs. And if you sign up at $5 a month at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons, you not only get the satisfaction of assisting me and Bob, but also a ton of bonus content. You get to hear next week's episode of Talking Simpsons a week ahead of time and ad-free, and also you get access to 2 monthly bonus podcasts, Talking Futurama, where me and Bob cover Futurama super in-depth, just like we do The Simpsons, and Talk King of the Hill, where we do it all over again for a new episode of King of the Hill each month. There's a giant back catalog, over 100 podcasts at that $5 level you can listen to, including us covering The Critic, Mission Hill, and our 10 favorite episodes of Batman the Animated Series. Check it all out for yourself at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. But if you want something even fancier than a Manhattan, then you should head over to patreon.com/talkingsimpsons and check out that premium tier. For $10 a month, you get all the $5 things I just mentioned, and then, oh boy, you get our exclusive monthly What a Cartoon Movie podcast, where me and Bob talk about an animated feature film super duper in depth, just like we do an episode of The Simpsons. Recent ones have included the crown jewel of our What a Cartoon Movies, Who Framed Roger Rabbit, where me and Bob talked for 6.5 hours about the 1988 animation live-action classic. You gotta sign up there to hear the full thing. And also at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons, your $10 a month subscription gets you all of our previous ones covering movies like South Park Bigger and Longer and Uncut, 1940s Pinocchio, and a huge back catalog going from everywhere from Akira to a Goofy movie, Beavis and Butthead to America to The Lion King, tons and tons more. Giant back catalog at your fingertips, over 250 hours of What a Cartoon movies, and at the end of this month, you'll hear us talk about Toy Story 3. Sign up at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons to see it all right now. You know, in the commentary, Nancy Cartwright is there for her first commentary ever, and she does bring it more than other cast members. Usually the other cast members there, and we love them, they're great, but they're usually just there to like laugh along and didn't really prepare all that much. It's like,
Julie
Kavner,
I just like hanging out with Julie Kavner. Oh, Bart's such a troublemaker.
but Nancy seemed to actually like dig out her old script and have notes on it, and like, remember this, I remember that, like that. I gotta give it to her for being more prepared than most of the actors are in the commentaries.
I was gonna say, listening to it, I did not realize that they say Cartwright and presumably Yardley Smith, etc. Is it Yardley or
Yardley?
Yardley Smith. They were not at the time publicly revealed as the specific characters they played. Like they tried to, maybe not by season three, but around that time. Was that another joke I'm not getting? Or
No. You're right.
That was true. They would appear in like baseball hats and sunglasses, and people wanted to know like which person did which voice, because they're always credited, everyone but the guest stars early on. But in one episode we did in season two, it's like they literally said Dan Castellaneta as Homer. They showed you who played everyone in the credits, just because people wanted to know.
Oh, that's old money.
It just seems wild that you know, nowadays, even if a show was really popular, an animated show was really popular, there would be no ability to hide from people, which was kind of a smart thing to do, especially that Bart Mania, you know, The Simpsons, the first two seasons was when it was such a craze, that it's just sort of shocking that they even were successful in keeping people from knowing who Bart was and who Lisa was for a while.
You know, back then, you really, in this pre-internet age, you really had to be in the know. Like, you had to be like reading Variety or LA Times pieces.
Yeah, trades.
Yeah, to know production on really anything. Like, in that, I think that is also why, like, there was a real tension in the staff of Matt Groening getting credit for everything on The Simpsons. But at the time, in the public imagination, they could remember one name associated with a TV show, and it was Matt Groening's the one that they memorized, you know?
One last thing about, you know, disguising the actors, you know, trying to make that a mystery. This is the fall season in which Herman's Head premieres, in which Yardley Smith plays a character with the voice of Lisa, because that is her voice.
Right.
When you tune in, you're like, that's Lisa Simpson. And
true.
Hank Azaria is on it too, using his normal voice. But yeah, just like, they really couldn't hide it anymore. You've got a sitcom on the same network with two of the main actors of the show.
Right.
And if you were a super fan like of The Simpsons, you probably knew Dan and Julie from Tracy Ullman from that. Though, I mean, I was six when I watched Tracy Ullman, so I didn't associate those human beings with the cartoon characters, but that's just me. But okay, the episode begins first with a little chalkboard gag about explosives in schools, which not so funny now. The episode begins like, I say this every time, but Rich Moore, like, it's not surprising he went on to be like an Oscar-winning theatrical animation director, because he's like, his episodes are great. Like, I don't know if I'd say I personally like his more than Jim Reardon or Wes Archer or David Silverman, because I think those are like the three kings, but Rich Moore does like amazing stuff every time. And he did The Monorail, which is like the most filmic episode of the show they ever did.
And Cape Fear, that was his last one he did for the show.
Truly maybe the peak of it. Animation in the series, and this opening of like, it's a pan across the room to Bart in his bed, and it's so, I just love that it's framed with a poster of Krusty, and then as you pan over you see more Krustys up to Bart's bed. Like, this episode is not about Krusty and Bart's love of Krusty, but it's just a great little character thing for a pan across the room.
Krusty is not involved with the mafia quite yet,
not yet
in the series.
That was shocking when you, because I looked that up too, of like, okay, and then Fat Tony, he must come back next season, because just in my head, I think of him as all the time around, but no, it's season six.
Three seasons later, yeah, that surprised me when you told me that. And is that Homie the Clown? Is that the one where he comes back?
Yeah, another John Swartzwelder script. And I think he remembered, oh, right, I have those characters I created. Why don't they show up again?
Why make up new mafia guys? Yeah.
Exactly. I love the cinematic, because is this still the Klasky Chupo?
This is the last season of the
because it has that. I feel most comfortable in that kind of season 5 through 7 zone where everything's been normalized, as I'm sure most people do. But there is something pretty great about seeing these earlier seasons, and there's a little bit more expression and a little bit more kind of creativity, you have to admit, you know, going on in the drawings.
Oh yeah, I love season 3. Things are less clamped down. You can get some wilder expressions, some more interesting camera moves. It looks really good.
Yeah, you know, I think it was going to be Splitsville for Klasky Chupo and The Simpsons after the first season. Like, I think their original deal was just 4 3 seasons, and once that was over, like, they didn't get along with Klasky Chupo at Gracie's. But they were doing so well in this season. Like, not the film Roman people do a great job, and I think season 4 and 5 especially look great also, but I think they did lose a little something. There's just a little magic to this season in its animation.
Definitely.
But yes, Bart jumps out of the wrong side of bed and steps on the pointiest of dinosaurs, the Stegosaurus. And you know, as a little kid, this sadly did not teach me to pick up stuff off the floor of my room. I would just a Spider-Man action figure is smooth anyway. It's not going to hurt you like a Stegosaurus.
That's why he's the most popular superhero. Is how smooth he is.
A Batman with his pointy ears, yeah. That's stabbing you right through the heel. Yeah.
Does Spider-Man have pointy?
That's why I'm not. Why I'm not seeing the new one. It's too pointy.
Does Spider-Man have to have like pointy villains? Like Electro, is he pointy?
Oh, Electro's all points. He's got like 5 stars around his thing.
Don't leave that on the ground, kids.
And and Green Goblin's long pointy nose and the point on his hat. Yeah, that's pointy.
Pointy ears as well as a goblin. You know,
you're right.
He's pointing all over the place.
Really just great animation of his like stepping on his hurt foot. Like, it's just very well observed.
I love the when the dog ate his homework, and I didn't know dogs really did that, but the equation that Santa's little helper spits out as an isolated equation is wrong also. Like, Bart's homework, he didn't do well on it, and we can actually see it. Like, that's the classic Simpsons that I know, going back in, because I haven't watched it since the last time I was on the show, and it felt nice to see just that multi-layered gag just unraveling, you know, so beautifully.
It's a great extra level to that joke, which is already good.
Yeah, he'd have been screwed anyway if he had put it in.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
But yes, it's a bad start to Bart's day in our first clip here.
Good morning, Lisa.
What are you so happy about?
Why shouldn't I be happy? It's a beautiful day. My homework is done. I got my mojo working, and we're going on a field trip this afternoon. And looks like I got me a genuine glow-in-the-dark police badge. Hey, it's not in here. You stole it!
No one wants your stupid police badge, Bart.
Hey, look what I got. A genuine official police badge. Calling all cars. Come out with your hands up.
Hey, that's my badge, Homer.
That's Officer Homer.
Oh, man, that's so... Okay, that was another thing I noticed in this episode. Swartzwelder really gets Homer. This Homer is the Homer. Mm-hmm. Like, he's a big, dumb child who does not understand the dangers in things, and he's just a comedy cartoon dude in this episode.
You guys have been, you know, obviously, you're embedded in all this, and I know you've been going back to these earlier seasons, like 1 and 2. What is this, like, early season 3? Does it snap right in, or are there episodes where he's not quite this Homer, and then in by 4 or 5 it's achieved? Do you see like a transition point for Homer?
I think by the end of 2 he's kind of this guy. Well, so in the end of production season 2 with When Flanders Failed, Homer is still kind of like just a dumber sitcom husband who has a very sitcom-y thing. Though in the more wacky blood feud at the end of season 2, where Homer has like, I don't know, like that, he's getting dumber and on Bart's childish level. But yeah, I think with the upcoming episodes, like, say, you know, we've got Flaming Moe in a few episodes, which is another big Homer episode. He's just a big dumb idiot who hates being like paying any attention to his family. Like, he just abandons his kids at a moment's notice. This is where they, a simile with Homer, they're like, no, we know what Homer is now. Like, no more. Why are we pretending he is like a regular dad in any form at this point? Yeah.
The Homer I think of before this, more than anything, is just a jerk. I mean, I know jerk-ass Homer, ironically, came way later. But I'm thinking of the Flanders one where I know he does the right thing in the end or whatever. But one of my favorite gags is when he's imagining Flanders increasingly in trouble and then he dies. And he goes, too far.
Yes.
Like that is he's more just kind of mean and irresponsible. But you're so right. When he walks in as pleased as a child would be at this toy, they've achieved a new level.
Yeah, I guess in Flanders failed, like Homer harbors a resentment for Flanders deep down when we know now he's like just too easily distracted to be to have like a vendetta like that, or to even
doesn't like him after that.
Yeah,
like he just thinks he's annoying, as opposed to the earlier more like adult Homer with more adult reasons to dislike Flanders, I guess.
Yeah, before he was stewing with like class-based resentment. Now like Flanders will appear in the window, go shut up Flanders, and then he'll go away. Yeah. And Homer will be happy again.
Like in those early Flanders episodes, Homer has like the cleverness to say something snide under his breath, and it's like, well, that's not Homer. Homer would just scream it. But yeah, in this case, he's like, but basically, he's Bart's older brother who stole the. He's not his father anymore. And I also love the inside the cereal box shot again. Just amazing shot.
Yeah, inside the cereal cabinet and then inside the box. Just these needless touches. We don't need to be inside of these little compartments, but they put us there. It's great
type of stuff they wouldn't do on the show anymore, you know. I hate to say, well, maybe no. Who's to say? Though also
negative Henry.
They also shout out that Swartzwelder wrote the gag on the box of Krusty saying only sugar has more sugar. But
A
great line.
Love that.
I also love
Lisa's eating Jackie O's.
Yes, yeah.
In keeping with her, well, I guess I don't know if that's a Lisa specific joke, but
you know, it's a Democrat, famous Democrat woman. I can see that. The stretch pants joke seems a little mean. Like, isn't that a fat joke at her expense that you would need stretch pants? Because, like, are they saying that Jackie O had gained weight? I looked at photos of her like 90 or 91, and I don't think she was particularly overweight. But I mean, people were mean back then.
I don't know if she was a famous stretch pants wearer. Now they're just called yoga pants or Spanx. People love them.
We all love them. Yeah. When I searched Jackie O 1991 news stories, it was one that was a story told many years after 1991, but it was apparently a friend of Jackie O's said about her posthumously that in 1991, she asked her friend to hook her up with Alec Baldwin, and she went on a date with Alec Baldwin in 1991. So, she was like 51 then, and Baldwin was 33. So,
good for her.
Yeah. Apparently it didn't go more than one night with her and Baldwin. Sadly though,
that is sad.
Give her a break. Her husband was killed. sorry.
What'd you say?
I said give her a break. Her husband was killed.
Yeah, I was about to say that sounds like one of the things the psychic would say in this episode. It's not looking good for Alec Baldwin and Jackie O.
And they were so happy.
Also, it's funny for an episode where Bart joins the real mafia. He couldn't be a fake cop. This is what happens, you know. If you can't become a cop, you become a mobster. There's only two options in the Italian immigrant world back then. But anyway, Santa's little helper eats his homework to Bart's shock that a dog actually does that. His excuse came through. Then it seems like Otto really screws Bart here, because he should realize, like, hey, Lisa is on here. I should probably wait for Bart. But
Lisa is oddly vindictive with this just sarcastic wave to Bart.
Yeah.
And then her at the candy factory saying he needs to learn his lesson.
I know.
This will teach him.
That also feels more Swartzwelder-y of like the way women are written in this one in general, I think.
Are there women in this rush besides Lisa? I can't even think of.
Marge says, I don't know if that's a good idea.
Exactly.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Exactly.
She's serving her role in this early part of the show.
This is also one of those moments on the commentary where I was like, God damn, they didn't save any of the deleted scenes for Klasky Csupo, or I still think it's possible they're technically owned. The footage is owned by Klasky Csupo and they don't want to make a deal with them. But they mentioned a deleted scene on this that they fully animated in color, not cut at the animatic, of what sounded brilliant. And I bet Rich Moore and his team did a great job of it, of like that Bart gets splashed by one car, but he's supposed to be splashed by cars like almost every step of his way to school. And they Richmore says they got all the way to color and it got cut. And I think that was just fun of like, it sounded like Richmore was getting his shots in of like, yep, you cut it. It looked really great and you cut it.
He said it was really hard to figure out.
Yeah.
He was mourning the loss of this joke.
Then Bart arrives and this is just a quick clip, but anytime I'm late, I think of the way Bart says this.
Bart Simpson, you're late. Go fill out a tardy slip.
But I'm only 5, 10, 20, 40 minutes. That's pretty damn late.
Just the acceptance of like that you're about to make an excuse, and then as you're counting the time, you're like, you know what? That is pretty late. You're right. You know?
I feel bad we're about to lose casually swearing Bart, though, in the show.
Yeah, yeah.
Because he was a bad influence in that respect.
I know. It wasn't that the censors told, that as we were told by John Vitti in our interview with him, that to take a shot, I mentioned to go back to an old interview, listeners. But in our interview with that, he said that it wasn't censors coming to them, but it was their colleagues in the comedy world who did have children who were like, well, thanks for teaching my kids the word bastard. And so they themselves pulled back on it for that very reason.
That is exactly why, as we discussed last time, that is exactly why I was not allowed to watch the show. My mom thought that if I watched Rugrats, Simpsons, whatever, kids are talking sass, and that I would immediately do the same thing. And for all I know, she's right. I never ended up watching them until I was older, so that was why.
We had that with we did the South Park movie recently, a whole podcast on that.
Oh, yeah.
And definitely the film is about, like, you know, moms shouldn't care so much about their kids swearing, but the start of the movie does clearly make the point of like, oh yeah, if kids went and saw an R-rated movie, they would say every swear word they heard over and over and over again. They would instantly repeat it. Yeah,
which I did anyway. I just, through osmosis, you know, I didn't see the primary source, but I'm glad I'm a grown up now and I can watch whatever I want.
Bart splits his pants in front of all the girls, saying, "Hey girls, look at me."
Laugh a lot.
Yeah, that's great.
I just love "look at me." Like, it's such a stupid, it's not really clever or funny. It's just really, it is funny to me that he just goes, "look at me," and his pants immediately split. That's not like classic Simpsons wit. It's just very funny that it immediately happens to him and he's a laughing stock. I love that.
You can stop looking at me now. That's great. and then Bart gets just smashed right in the face with a kickball, crashes to the ground, and probably concussed, I would guess. And you know, they don't do this animation choice. I like it, though. Like, the reddening under his eye is really well done.
Yeah, it's like a little airbrushed almost.
Mm-hmm. That's not how they do like a black eye later in the series, but it's very realistic. And then Bart thinks, finally, though, all this pain today will be worth it, because he's gonna get to go on the field trip.
Well, it's nearly 1 o'clock, and you know what that means.
Yay!
That's right. It's time for our field trip to the chocolate factory. I trust you all remembered to bring your permission slips.
Oh, what a day.
I'm gonna eat 8 pieces of chocolate.
How many chocolate till I barf?
Don't worry, Bart. We'll find something fun for you to do. Ah, here we are. There's a whole box of unsealed envelopes for the PTA.
You're making me lick envelopes?
Oh, licking envelopes can be fun. All you have to do is make a game of it.
What kind of game?
Well, for example, you could see how many you can lick in an hour, and then try to break that record.
Sounds like a pretty crappy game to me.
Yes, well, get started.
I mean, this was my greatest fear as a child in school, and one that gave me even more anxiety about this whole forgetting your permission slip. It never happened to me.
Man, I figure you could just call your parent now, and parents are much more reachable, and just say like, if you forgot it. But yeah, I never missed a permission slip. Though also now I think as an adult, this episode I had no questions about as a kid. As an adult, I'm like, come on, a trip to the chocolate factory, that starts, you don't do any part of the school day. You go there at like 9 a.m., you get on that bus. You don't go there one. But
I also really liked how the permission slip is beautifully and pristinely laid out right under his pillow, like just waiting to be remembered, and he somehow missed it.
And just that real, I mean, it is very, we've all been there of like, just in the middle of the day it hits you like, I left that at home, like I didn't bring it with me, god damn it. Just
and then you scream.
And then you scream, man, what a scream by Nancy, too. Speaking of people, like, getting out aggression on the commentary, I like she mentions, like, boy, we worked, like, from 10 to 6 on a lot of these episodes back then. And Al Jean is kind of like, well, you know, we just wanted a lot of good lines. We were probably overdoing it then. I'm sorry. great scream. And I love, like, his face kind of, the way his face splats into the book, like, that's another just, like, great animation bit there. And also, yeah. When the pan to his house, like, I love all the crazy, like, squiggly lines they do for, like, long pans. Always great.
It's really cool zip pan.
Yeah. I would think that the Harvard nerds who write on this show probably went through a lot of, like, high school envelope stuffing things for transcript boosting purposes like this. But, yeah, also, when I talk about things leveling up for this episode, I absolutely feel that with Skinner as well. So Skinner definitely was a nerd who loved his mama in even in his second or third appearance in season one, but he still was like, he's the stern principal, even in season two. In this episode, while he is Bart's stern principal, he also is a big nerd who loves stupid, boring games like this.
And science. I was going to say at the end, I don't want to skip to the end fully, but like at the end, I love that it sets up the, you know, basis of what, you know, in Bart's Comet, most famously, that he's a big science nerd and MacGyvers himself because he loves science so much.
This is the Skinner who loves Diorama Rama Day, who says every type of detergent in front of him slowly. Like this, this is that Skinner. Like this is them leveling up Skinner to the character we love. Like, yeah, this is just so it's just so magical to see once they start season three, like just them figuring out, like finally locking it all into place for so many characters.
Yep. The only thing that's just a little bit older style is his voice is a little bit more kind of hoity-toity. He's got that kind of like
it's more stern,
more deeper.
Yeah.
but his character at this point is pretty much the Skinner that you know. Skinner's one of my favorite characters. I can't imagine that's unpopular. Mm. And it felt like it didn't feel like they were still figuring him out when I turned this on.
And they apparently got that crappy past the censors because they said it's an adjective, not a noun, to describe, you know, feces. It's crappy. Which we head to the All Fudge Chocolate Factory. Sadly, you know, they never, All Fudge was not a consistent thing. It, you know, from then on, if they wanted to do like candy, it's the Krusty Bar. Like they kind of centralize all their businesses around Krusty after that.
Coco Beanie never returned.
Oh, I love him. The way he goes, hur, hur, hur. Like, God, what a great little sound he made.
It's Coco Beanie himself. I just love that Milhouse has been thinking about this for years.
He's been dreaming of it. He is the nerds who love the mascots going to stuff. And by that, I mean us as well. And me, at least, sure. I'll say. But I've never toured a chocolate factory. I have, as a kid, toured the Coca-Cola factory. And as an adult, went to the Jelly Belly factory in California. Which is known for its painting in jelly beans of Ronald Reagan. It's a very pro-Reagan jelly bean.
That's his favorite. That was his favorite food. Mm-hmm. Seriously.
And I mean, if you're a California Republican, which I'm sure the owners of the Jelly Belly factory are, then he's like God to you, Ronald Reagan.
Speaking of that, this is a little bit of a tangent, but fun fact, Scott Walker, former Wisconsin governor, is such a Reagan freak that on his own birthday, which I don't know if it's because he shares a birthday with Reagan, maybe that's why, he like dresses everyone up, you know, in like America stuff and has everyone come and he serves jelly beans and he like plays Reagan movies and it's like he reenacts all of Reagan's favorite things to do in his life.
That's creepy.
And, you know, tracks with his... with his personality.
He pretends to have dementia towards the end of the day.
he just stumbles around, talks about how he liberated death camps that he never did. Yeah, all that stuff.
If it's like 4:30 in the afternoon, he doesn't recall a lot of stuff. He's like, yeah.
Exactly. It's a sunset. But I always thought that was one of the most disturbing things I ever heard, is that you serve jelly beans on your birthday because Reagan liked them.
God, that's it is creepy. But hey, Jelly Belly, they make some good beans.
I bet they do.
Yeah, but... But yeah, the Aw Fudge, I just love, it's called Aw Fudge. Like, what a funny name for it. And yeah. All right, and talking about leveling up stuff. Okay, so yes, Troy McClure had appeared before. Mm-hmm. He had even said in his first appearance, you may remember me. But what he didn't do was host a video for children to watch. Like, this, it was an infomercial. Like, this is them really figuring out Troy McClure as well, I think.
And Phil Hartman didn't know if he wanted to do this again. His response to them was, yeah, it was kind of fun, guys, but I don't want this to be a regular thing. But then he eventually like leaned into it, embraced the character, and we'd be back countless times.
So many
and
times.
And like in the early parts of the show, they have him playing multiple characters throughout, just like when John Lovitz would come on earlier.
Yeah, yeah.
And he's the guy who says, I did not know this, he's the guy who says the wonderful line, what have I done to deserve this flavorless Manhattan, apparently. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't have even necessarily guessed that.
No, he's great. I miss hearing him as one-off voices in later episodes, but I can see why they're like, you know, it's distracting now if you hear a Hartman voice as somebody else. But yeah, I love hearing him as secondary one.
And that's why Hutz is back too.
Yeah. Oh God. And yeah, this also is kind of a sequel to, you know, the second episode ever of The Simpsons is the kids touring the nuclear plant, and they get pretty similar sequence to this, except it's hosted by Smilin' Joe Fishin. This is a way better version of that also, like, just so good. And it's made that way because Troy McClure is perfect. Like, he's just, the way he walks up to the podium that's shaped like a chocolate bar and leans over it, like, just
I love that.
Perfect. But yes, let's hear good old Troy my man.
Welcome to the Chocolate Factory. I'm Troy McClure. You probably remember me from such films as The Revenge of Abe Lincoln and The Wackiest Covered Wagon in the West. The history of chocolate starts with the ancient Aztecs. In those days, instead of being wrapped in a hygienic package, chocolate was wrapped in a tobacco leaf. And instead of being pure chocolate like we have today, it was mixed with shredded tobacco. And they didn't eat it. They smoked it.
You didn't believe me when I said it would be fun, did you?
No, sir.
Sorry, I want to get just a little of that in there, but
you know, Troy's a professional. I love his welcome to the Chocolate Factory.
Oh, the chocolate factory.
almost sounds like ominous. Mm. He says it in a very low, rumbling voice,
almost sexual. I'd say that. Yeah,
he loves it.
I, you know, my internal guess here, I'm maybe just making up canon here, but I think Aw Fudge is owned by Laramie Cigarettes, and that's why they have such a long sequence of showing kids how fun it is to smoke tobacco.
I like it. And in case
I totally agree with that. I thought that was kind of the underbelly of the gag, that if you're really, it's just like, why are these kids being shown so, you know, meticulously how to smoke?
And if you didn't get the Chief Wahoo gag, he just does the smile at the end.
Yep. Yeah, he does. Yeah. Which I definitely view as them mocking how blatantly racist the character of Chief Wahoo was even then.
I agree. It's one of those gags that, you know, because it's an old, I don't know how old it's supposed to be. Troy McClure's not that young in it, but like it's an old stuffy video where you would see that kind of dated stuff in school. And so I think it's one of those gags that actually ages better, you know, because as that stereotype gets, you know, ages more and more poorly, you know, the a gag like that, you just go, oh my God. And the shock value like kind of hits even harder.
I think I said this before on the podcast. I grew up in Ohio. For the longest time, I didn't know Chief Wahoo was supposed to be a person. I thought he was like a baseball demon. Because if you look at the Kansas City Chiefs or, you know, the Redskins, the head looks like a person's head. It's still racist, but this is like some 1930s caricature that does not look like a human being at all. I know that's the point, but I was like, this is a person?
Yeah, like that's what, again, it's just, it's so, it strikes especially the modern eye as just so out there and bizarre that this was supposed to be like a normal depiction of anything, which of course, you know, it wasn't. It was a fantastical racist image. So yeah, it is ridiculous, but I love that. That's a really good early McClure video. And I love The Wackiest Covered Wagon in the West.
And according to Wikipedia, the Aztecs and cocoa beans, nothing to do with tobacco. Like, I think they just like make it up. Like, certainly the Aztecs used it a lot. It was some of the people they conquered would be forced to make it and grow them as part of their crops. They were used as like money as well. And they drank their chocolate cold as well, the Aztecs, of course. And they would be used as rations for Aztecs. Aztec soldiers. So, and hey, it was from Wikipedia, so it must be true. And yeah. It's totally, he totally fine to source it. But yeah, as Bart, I also just love Bart watching these slow seconds get slower and slower and then tick backward again. Just amazing reverse. Joke. Such a good joke.
Excellent joke. I love how just awful and ragged his tongue has become. That the little like bumps, the like yellow bumps just showing like it's sandpaper at this point.
Oh god, yeah, it's so painful. And you know what, I look, sometimes when your glasses drop, you do have to say my glasses. Like, it's what else can you say in those moments?
You're letting everyone know, don't move.
Yes, my glasses, stop, my glass. Yeah, it's just what you got to say. God, all that stuff is so gross with the chocolate mayhem. Disgusting. Like, especially, I think it's a very intentional choice that it's Wendell the barf kid who's swimming around in the chocolate. If it could be any kid, it's Wendell doing it. And the shot of Ralph on the conveyor belt, that's another great shot.
Yes.
It is.
Ralph is coming into his own too. Like, everyone is emerging in this episode. Yeah. Really. Yeah.
The Simpsons got a lot out of going to a factory humor, because you mentioned they've already done it once. The box factory, one of the best things. The cracker factory that Milhouse's dad works at. It's they did not run out of factory stuff for a long time.
And let's not forget the cider town as well. Yeah,
of course. Yeah. Oh my god, yeah.
Yes, also they were really into Harry Shearer playing effeminate men who tell people like, play sanitary children. Like, he just was so, they had him do at least one effeminate voice in episode. This is a smitherless episode, so they have to get the gay voice out of a different guy.
He's in it, but he's not saying anything.
Oh, that's true.
He say something, even though they reuse old footage?
Yes.
I barely count that scene. I don't like that. We'll get to it. But you're right. Okay. You are. Okay. I stand corrected. But yes, the kids beating and kicking Coco Beatty, like, that's also just great. And then, yes, the sound of the sandpaper against Bart's tongue. I just have a quick clip here of it because, like, again, I think Nancy does a really, I'm glad she's on the commentary, because she is really great this whole episode.
Can I go now?
What?
Can I go now?
Well, there's still a minute to go. No, why not? But don't you tell your teacher I'll let you go home early.
I don't.
That's so great. And Bart does right with his left hand. I'm on left hand watch.
Okay.
Since we just did the Leftorium one. So, but yeah, just is that Seymour again. What a great nerdy Skinner thing that he like is thinks it's delightfully devilish to let Bart out 30 seconds early from school. And he's just like, like, it's so cute. His dorkiness. Yeah. And so yes, Bart leaves. It instantly starts raining on him. All the kids are in the bus coming back from their fun chocolate factory, splashing Bart. How can it get any worse? Bart, like, the wheel breaks off his skateboard and he tumbles down the stairs right in front of the legitimate businessman's social club. And Bart gets a whole bunch of guns pointed at him, which...
Oh, great shot.
Yes.
That, if somebody has that cell, it must cost like $80,000.
It's a perfect cell. It's so great. I, not to brag, but I did use it for a slightly viral post about Simpsons opinions. I said, hey, what? I was scrounging for it. I wanted to go viral. I was like, okay, everybody's got the knives pointing at people spot. I know there's a scene like that from Simpsons. I'm gonna take that shot and ask people for their what Simpsons opinion will get you this thing, like, and everybody fell for it, and it was great. It was a great day for me.
Genius.
That's all that matters now.
Yeah, hey, it's engagement. You just ask an open-ended question with a good picture. That's playing Twitter now. That's how it is. Don't hate the game, guy. But all right, so yes, you wonder why Bart has a bunch of guns pointed at him. It also is like, this is the beginning of the Simpsons love a cocked gun. Like, there's so many jokes in the show about cocking a gun at somebody.
Well, it's and it is funny. There's something just, it immediately ups the stakes in a way that is somehow comical, where now life or death is involved, you know, where it wasn't a second ago. It is funny every time.
And so yes, we get our first introduction to Fat Tony and the rest of his mobster regulars, which there wouldn't really be a consistent new member of the crew until season 12 with Johnny Tightlips.
And what about Jimmy the Scumbag?
And Jimmy, all right, Jimmy the Scumbag in 9, you're right. right. Yeah. but yeah, Fat Tony, based on Paul Sorvino's Goodfellas character. And yeah, I think, you know, if they'd gotten Sheldon Leonard, he'd be dead by like after his second appearance, he'd be dead.
And there's some interesting Fat Tony lore, because technically he dies in the season 22 episode Donnie Fatso, but the big gimmick is he's replaced with Fit Tony, and the stress of being in the mafia makes him overeat. He turns back into Fat Tony. So as a gimmick, they replace, it's sort of like a Armin Tamzarian kind of situation, but no one freaked out about it. It's just like, he's a new character now, but it's still Joe Montana. We're still doing the same jokes. And that happened now, like, over a decade ago.
Snowballs 2 has been dead for a long time. But yeah, that's great. I have to remind myself, in canon, this Fat Tony's been dead for about 12 years now, I think, or so, or at least a decade. Because Homer was, it's called Donnie Fatso, because Homer is, he's wearing a wire when meeting Fat Tony. Yeah.
And you know what? I'm sad we never went there, but his Burbank restaurant, Taste Chicago, closed in 2019.
Oh, no. Yeah. Oh, wow. I would have figured the pandemic would shut it down.
Nope. Man. It was open for over a decade.
Wow. That's too bad, man. I would want, you know, if I'm going to have an Italian beef sandwich from anywhere, I'd want it served to me by Joe Monte. at least, you know, I hope the Danny Trejo restaurants we ate at in Burbank or in Hollywood are still open. Those were both the donut place and the taco place were really good.
And do you think they went to him because he was in Godfather 3? That's the reason, right?
Yeah, Godfather 3 was also 1990, I mean, Godfather 3, I thought there was like a slight critical reappraisal of it as not that bad recently, or there was a re-release of it, but...
It was like a recut version. Coppola put it out and called it the Coda or something. I didn't really understand. I just saw an ad for it. I didn't look into it further.
And everybody was really mean to Sofia Coppola about that too, which...
she showed them.
Yeah, she sure did. it's insane that the Coppola is just like, it's like they own Hollywood. They own a chunk of Hollywood, their entire family of them. Like, there's too many of them.
Jason Schwartzman's one of them too.
He is.
Don't forget that. Yep. Let's talk Brandon.
One of my favorite lines from the Larry Sanders Show is when Hank is making a goodbye tape for Larry, and he has Bruno Kirby, and he keeps giving Bruno Kirby notes to shoot this dumb little happy birthday wish on tape. And Bruno Kirby's like, I can't believe I'm getting notes. I was in The Godfather. And he goes, Hank's like, I don't remember you in that. He goes, yeah, Godfather Part 2. And he goes, I've only seen the third one, you know.
We have to talk about...
Let's talk about it.
Frank Severo. He played Frankie Carbone in Goodfellas. You know, honestly, a very minor character.
So my little weird obsession with that character is an actual topic here.
Absolutely.
Didn't even realize this.
No, absolutely. He's a very unique looking man. This is a caricature of him. I don't think Legs is a caricature of anyone in the movie, though maybe I should look through all the mobsters and try to place him.
Legs with his slick back hair and all that, to me, the one he looks the most like is Tony Cicero, the future Polly Walnuts, who's in the movie. Like, he has the very slick back hair, and his hair was that color then.
Okay.
Not the perfect, you know, gray wingtip hair we all love of Polly Walnuts and Sopranos.
And in the movie, he does do the, listeners can't see, but I'm doing the Polly Walnuts index and pinky hand wave. Yeah. He does that in Goodfellas.
That's true. Yeah.
Well, Frank Severo tried to sue The Simpsons in 2014, so 13 years after this airs. He tried to sue, I guess, Gracie or Fox.
It was Fox Television,
For $250 million because they drew a caricature of him based on how he appeared in Goodfellas. Yeah.
Yeah, which...
I had no idea.
And again, it's so funny on the commentary knowing that... because the commentary, I believe, is 2002. They don't know in 12 years they're going to be sued by the guy, but they're just like Rich Moore saying that Al Jean is like, is that supposed to be Mike Reese? And then because they drew like 8 characters that look like Mike Reese on the show.
He's a fun looking man.
Rich Moore's like, oh no, I thought I told him to do Joe Pesci, which I was like, wait, what? Because it's not just his poofy hair looks like Frank Severo, but it's like the cheeks.
He's a very hatchet faced man.
Yes. Yeah. And
he looks like he's a dead ringer for the Goodfellas character. That's why, without knowing this entire story, I just assumed it was him.
And Bob, you linked me to a great deconstruction of the whole thing from Cartoon Brew that kind of put it all into perspective once his final appeal went through in 2018, but he lost that lawsuit to Fox.
I think he had like never seen The Simpsons before because he made some wild claims. Like, I think in his head, Frank Severo thinks this is the Louis show because he said, oh yeah, in 89 I was living near some of the writers and they obviously saw me and got ideas for this character. He thinks this Louis guy is just like the biggest. He's like another like Skinner or Flanders on the show. Louis is probably has like 100 lines total across 30 years.
That's really funny.
I bet you could find, if you were searching for merchandise that featured Louis, like I'd say at best you'd find like 3 toys tops of him, or like maybe a car trading card or whatever.
And Louis is always Dan Castellaneta doing a Joe Pesci impression. In this episode and in Homie the Clown, it's Hank Azaria doing a kind of De Niro for legs, but after that, Harry Shearer plays legs.
Oh, right. Yeah. I forgot they swap. Yeah. Also, that Cartoon Brew story you linked me to, Bob, they make a great point about how, like, from a cartoon production standpoint, it's really good that he had no chance with this lawsuit, but if it had actually succeeded, it would have kind of fucked up all cartoons because the judge was like, this is a transformative work and it's a free speech thing. You are a public celebrity and they drew a caricature of you. Even if they intentionally did so, it's no different from, you know, the 8 million Bugs Bunny cartoons where he meets like Clark Gable or Humphrey Bogart, you know, like,
they couldn't show the Sherry Bobbins episode anymore.
Yes. Yeah. It would have destroyed parody law if the guy had won. So, I mean, hey, I think they should just give him $2 million, Disney. What's it to you? You know,
yeah, throw him something.
Yeah, he's
not $250 million or whatever you said.
And it's extra funny though that to read how the court case was settled, because it's exactly what Marge describes to Homer at the end of this episode. Like, that's that legal precedent is so that's an extra funny end to it. But really, I'm shocked they didn't make him just Pesci. Like, Pesci is like the most, who remembers Frankie Carbone from Goodfellas? Like, you remember his death. That's the only thing I can think
he's
of that actor.
He's on the meat hook.
Yeah. But Joe Pesci was so good at Goodfellas. He got cast in everything to just like, can you just do that in this comedy now?
It rules that just a few months later, he was one of the Wet Bandits.
Right.
Just a few months later in cinemas.
And swearing.
And then came
up
back
storm.
For a sequel. He loved being a Wet Bandit.
But yes, let's hear. Why don't we hear our first ever appearance of Fat Tony?
Hey, what's with the kid?
Hands off the material.
What do you know? The kid's tough.
He's got spunk.
I wonder if he is lucky also. Pick a horse, kid. Shelbyville Downs, third race. Make it a good one.
Eat my shorts.
Eat my shorts. Ah, okay. Let's see. Hey, wait a minute, you little punk. Eat my shorts is in the fifth race. I said the third race.
Don't have a cow.
Don't have a cow in the third. Put a deuce on him. While we are waiting to see how lucky you are, let me show you around. This is our bar, and over there is our slot machine and card tables.
Cool.
Hey, boss, here's the call for the third race.
As they come out of the turn, it's suffering succotash by a neck over yabba-dabba-doo. 2 lengths back to eight, I stinker, and that's all, folks. I am what I am, can see them all. But here comes Don't Have a Cow, flying on the outside, and at the wire, hits all. Don't Have a Cow!
Hey, I like this kid. I can't believe we were gonna shoot him. Can you mix drinks?
I don't know.
I'll have a Manhattan.
Make legs a Manhattan.
I'm not sure.
Like, again, the second time in the episode, a joke is punctuated with guns cocking. Like, that's such a Simpsons saying.
Again, it's been a little while, but Eat My Shorts is in the fifth race. That whole setup still caught me off guard. I thought it was just going to be a cute little joke how Bart's being sassy. And then it's like, nope, they always go the extra mile. They always take it to the logical conclusion.
We were talking about how good this episode looks. One thing I associate with season three is, like, lots of shadows. It's a lot of extra work. It's an extra layer. It's an extra bit of figuring things out. And they're always in shadows in the social club. And also, when Fat Tony is showing off both sides of the club,
oh my God,
the in-camera animation move, it's great. It's not just panning across one piece of artwork. It's like drawing a new frame for every time the camera is moving across the background. That's a lot of work they didn't have to do, but it looks so good, and most people won't even notice it.
It's so opulent. Like, even in a great season like season 8, I don't think they do that shot. They would just say, like, over here is that, cut to just a shot of that, and over here is this, and then they just cut to it, and you wouldn't miss it. You wouldn't be like, oh, that looks cheap, because the joke would be expressed, but this extra sauce like is just so great. Like
sauce. Yeah, this gravy, this extra
it's
gravy.
It's the gravy.
But yeah, I so agree. That's what I meant watching this. This has been observed before, I'm sure, but it's like The Simpsons isn't really a show where you need that extra craft or like cinematic touch. So you like you say, you don't miss it. There's even something maybe funny about the kind of more direct hard cuts that would happen in later seasons of that kind of that's a very Simpson-like thing to just then hard cut to something rather than do a kind of flowery cinematic lead up to a joke. But we get both in the golden era, I guess, because these earlier seasons, it really is lovely to see. That shot you're talking about really stood out to me. I thought it was so cool looking.
And they have so many great jokes in the series about the show's popularity, but this is a good like underrated one that Bart's cartoon catchphrase is now on the level of all those other ones in universe. The don't have a cow is, and also this is like a joke about don't have a cow being tired and the thing from t-shirts. I think this is the last time Bart says don't have a cow himself, or at least for years and years. I think the next time it's said is when Lisa says it as a joke pretending to be him in season 7.
And then they do it in the Simpsons spinoff showcase when Bart sings his verse. He's like, eat my shorts, don't have a cow.
That's right. Yes. Yeah. So then they instruct him to make a Manhattan, and also put a deuce on it. It's definitely a parlance for a bet, but I couldn't find like in horse racing terms what a deuce means. Deuce in other gambling scenarios, it means certain other things.
I assumed it was like 200 or 2000 or something like that.
There's the best I could find was there was a 1965 Sports Illustrated article about this new thing in horse racing, which is looking at statistics of how many times a horse has won. And it's like, wow, you need a computer for all this stuff. And the headline was, before you put a deuce on a horse, you better run the computer. It was used in the same way he did, which that is more of the Schwarzwelder old-timey mobster movie way of talking they give these characters. And yeah, so Bart is instructed to mix a drink. So on the thing Bart has in front of him, I believe that is an accurate way to make a Manhattan, but it asks for an Italian whiskey, which, I mean, would fit for what the mafia would want, though I think more commonly it is rye whiskey is the main whiskey you use in a Manhattan. I've never mixed one for myself. I probably ordered them at a bar just because I was like, oh, I should have one of these like from the show. But it's not my preferred cocktail. I think, I like a little fruit in a cocktail, but I guess I like a little more fruit. Instead, just the hint of cherry.
Who are you kidding, Henry? You are a girl drink drunk.
I am a girl drink drunk. It's true. Yes. But
I'm not really into Manhattans, but it looks strangely appetizing in the show. It's
like
how
great.
In cartoons, everything tastes, you know, like candy when you're a kid. You're like, oh, that probably tastes like, I think of that Peep Show moment. Sorry to bring up Peep Show on the Simpsons podcast, but where Jeremy is taking someone out to dinner and he ends up buying a really expensive bottle of wine and regretting it because it's too pricey, and then he finally drinks it and he's trying to hide his disappointment, and he's like, yeah, really delicious. I mean, not actually delicious like Coca-Cola or hot chocolate, but for wine, delicious. But the Manhattan looks tasty in this, so yes, I'll give it that.
Speaking of bad influences, when I was a kid watching this, I thought those look pretty good, these drinks look good.
And here's a 10-year-old just like me making them. I bet it looks really great. I think,
you know, we just shook loose this memory in my mind that I actually got a call to my parents in fourth grade because I wrote like a short story or just some of this activity where I said, eat my shorts in it. Like my character said it. Because I hadn't watched The Simpsons, but I heard Bart say that and I wanted to look cool and for my friends making a funny line. So I stole the funny line from a popular thing. And then it was naughty. And that doubled my mom's opposition to The Simpsons because I had been, you know, gotten in trouble for saying something naughty in school. So these are coming back to me as we talk.
It's so funny because Bart didn't invent Eat My Shorts. I gave him just like a corny old thing he would have seen on TV or something. Like, Eat My Shorts is such an old catchphrase. It took me a long time before I realized shorts means underwear.
Yeah, right, right.
It doesn't mean like the shorts I'm wearing.
Yeah. Yeah. You know what's a really, what always sounded like a really nasty one that's in a wholesome show is sit on it.
Yeah.
In Happy Days. Sit on it. I mean, I don't think it takes that much imagination to imagine what you could be telling someone to do.
Yeah.
Yet it's in the wholesome 50s universe where Ron Howard and Potsy are saying it. It's
that was
weird.
Their way of saying get fucked.
Yeah.
Exactly.
That's what
exactly.
The gritty Happy Days reboot will be Fonzie saying get fucked.
When they do the Riverdale version of Happy
yeah.
Days.
Hey, there's
like. Be like, sit and spin, motherfucker.
There's like a dramatic Fresh Prince of Bel Air show on now. So let's get the dramatic. Yeah. Gritty Happy Days.
Yeah,
they weren't all happy days, Marge.
We can't get too sidetracked, but I'm so curious what the fuck that is. I assume it's like the Riverdale thing, but what is going on? What is happening?
I'd heard all right stuff about it, but yeah, I haven't watched it yet either.
It may be good. It's just baffling to me.
I mean, you got to remake something. You can't make a new thing. So you got to remake something. You know?
No, you're right. You're right.
Well, I mean, honestly, I think about how Many Saints of Newark just came out, and I've been thinking to myself, like, if Tony Soprano's actor was still alive, they would just be making it. Like, it would just be, yeah. Like, they'd just do a new season. They would flush away all the thoughts of, like, yeah, I know what you thought the ending of Sopranos was, yep. But you know what? We just decided that's not the ending, and so we're just making more of it, and Tony's old
it's
now.
It's a terrible truth, but there is something, I don't know what to say, but there's something, there's a bright side, there's a silver lining to the tragedy of James Gandolfini's death, and that his most iconic and celebrated role cannot be fucked up by trying to do a cash grab on the series. It's true.
I mean,
they did it anyway, but not with him.
Yes, yeah, with, you know, that Many Saints, if they just didn't have Christopher do the that movie would be like 20% better if he wasn't doing voiceover in it. That's what I think. I
didn't see it.
Oh,
I didn't
really?
Even know he was doing it. Yeah, I was told it was pretty goofy. The one thing that I respect, this isn't a totally original thought, my friend was kind of saying this, and I do respect it as well, that Chase has contempt for, most fans of the show.
Oh, yeah.
And so what I've heard, sorry if this is a spoiler, I haven't even seen it, but I am spoiling the movie, at least the kind of narrative satisfaction at the end is centered around a black man who has nothing to do with the rest of the series and is his own character in this movie. And it is emphatically not some kind of like, fan service to how tough Italians have to stick together or whatever. It's like the exact opposite of what all those guys would want. And even though I don't think that justifies doing some shitty follow-up to The Sopranos, I like that he still has the hate in his heart and put that in this highly anticipated, among that crowd, highly anticipated Sopranos send-off. That's pretty great.
That, yes, I agree with that. Though I think it is, there still is a lot of fan service in it, a whole lot, which,
yeah,
hey, sure, I was whooping it up at home of like, Junior finally said he doesn't have the makings of a college athlete. Like, I love it. Like, just so. Also, I got so Soprano pilled. I'm now done rewatching Sopranos, Bob, so I'm not living Sopranos as much as I did. But when I think of these Manhattans, I was like, oh yeah, lately I had been just drinking like whiskey or cognac on the rocks straight because that's how Tony drinks it in the show. I was like, yeah, I'm like Tony drinking my straight whiskey out of the glass. I'm such a cool guy like Tony Soprano.
You're gonna get a tattoo, a really, really awful tattoo, like a photorealistic tattoo of James Gandolfini that says like respect is family or whatever on you.
Why isn't anybody like Gary Cooper anymore? Well, whatever happened to Gary Cooper? That's why she got across my heart now. But
can I just say to get us, I think I ripped us off track. I love Montaigne's, he's doing, it's that halted speech with Fat Tony where it's like a very insightful way to, because he could have just done the joke in a lot of other characters is, well observed and, supoib and all that. But his way of finding a funny way to personify those mob guys where it's that kind of really sleazy halting dialogue. It's a different episode where he goes, you crack us so consistently up.
Yes.
When he's talking to Krusty, like that's a really, really great way to have your funny Simpsons mob guy sound.
And apparently he based the voice off of an uncle who has since passed away, but I believe that uncle got to sit in on a recording of him doing the voice and the uncle really appreciated
it. Yeah, yeah.
Lovely. Lovely.
And yeah, they say that like Joe Mantegna, they love working with him. They say, I believe the famous Al Jean line is, if Fat Tony sneezes, Joe Mantegna's playing it. Like he does the sneeze.
He loves coming back.
And then, so Bart comes home. He tells his parents he's got a job fixing drinks, picking horses, cutting cigars, you know, a job. But this again, I was like, oh, this is such perfect Homer. Like, this is Marge is distrustful, but in an innocent way. And Homer is just shoveling ice cream out of the thing into his mouth and just going like, what? Like, he doesn't care that he's in this episode. He doesn't give a shit. Like, so yep, funny.
And that line, I make more than that, is just. Is awesome.
Yeah, I got it. It's just, and Bart's $30 a week would be worth $61 now, according to an online inflation count.
He's being shortchanged.
Well, you know what? It's really a lot of tips. When he says 30 a week, right. I mean, you see, he's getting the tips. That's where the money's at. And then, so this sequence here, this is the good fella-iest scene in the whole thing. Apparently, they originally wanted Be My Baby, which is a better song than One Fine Day, but probably more expensive.
That song wasn't in Goodfellas. Frosty the Snowman, the Ronettes singing that was in Goodfellas. I think it's the only Ronettes song.
You know, again, the needle drop soundtrack of Goodfellas, like, ruined movie soundtracks after that. Like, everybody's like, oh, I can just put, like, back-to-back-to-back-to-back pop hits that people will recognize and sets them in time, you know?
It like, so many good things, you know, it created a subgenre that is 90% garbage or predictable crap. Did you guys ever see the guy E from Entourage made a movie? What was – oh, the Gotti movie. That's what I'm
Gotti,
thinking of.
Yep, yeah.
God damn, I've only seen clips.
I think the marketing for that was basically reviewers don't want you to see it. They think you're stupid if you like it.
Yeah.
Everyone's saying this movie is shitty and it sucks really bad. That means that the critics, we touched a nerve and everyone actually wants to see. I remember, sorry, this is a gangster related show. I figure, you know, it's somewhat related. I went with some of my former colleagues Will and Felix to go see it, and we were like making jokes on the way there about like respect, but it's all going to be about this really dumb version of like we're saying, like Goodfellas, you know, for toddlers. It's all going to be about respect and family and New York, my city. And the movie opens, it's like accordion music, there's like, you know, Mulberry Street, and John Travolta literally he's on the river and he turns to the camera and says, New York, my fucking city. It's about respect. And we're just like, our minds are like melting that it's in the first 5 seconds. It's everything we've just been making fun of that we didn't actually think was going to be in the first 5 seconds. Just YouTube like Gotti intro and you'll be overwhelmed. And then you'll be overwhelmed if you Google also the ending where it's just like real footage of all these insane people who loved Gotti and like Staten Island being like, he kept the city safe, you know, blah, blah, blah. Just watch Gotti is what I'm saying.
It shows you what movie Christopher Moltisanti would have made after Cleaver. That's really what it would have been. Because
another amazing Sopranos like self-crit or just very, very tactful way of doing that. I love the whole Cleaver plot. It's pitch perfect.
But yeah, I mean, these scenes are very similar to like just him training in Henry Hill's training montage, I guess I almost called it, but in Goodfellas of him, you know, he gets handed some money. He's just like, I never see money like this. Everybody loves him. Like Justin, it's a great sequence to just explain why people join the mafia, why people like it, why it's cool, why how they also indoctrinate a child to be their child soldier in their group. Also, my guess is that One Fine Day, this is a cover song. My guess is the singer Sally Stevens, because she's usually who they would hire to do a female cover. It was Kip Lennon if it was a man usually, and most famously I think she sings the Scorpio song. Scorpio. Yes, and just like in in Goodfellas too, like they find money and like, hey, where'd you get this money? No, don't you worry, doll. and also, here's something I noticed for the first time though. Among the nondescript mobsters, once the song's over, it goes to the itchy scratchy thing at the bar with the other mobsters watching it. There's a bald guy there who I think is just a pair. I think it's meant to look like Dan Castellaneta.
I was thinking the same thing.
Okay, good.
He's an Italian guy. Yes. We know what he looks like. Let's draw him into the show.
I know. That's what
why not?
That's good. All right. I wish he kept showing up. Maybe Dan was like, hey, I don't like that.
Yeah. No, absolutely. The guy at the far end of the bar, that's Dan Castellaneta.
100%. Yeah. Yeah. They do a lineup against the wall in the Itchy and Scratchy cartoon and just shoot them all, which I always think is a real reference to a thing.
I always enjoy when the Itchy and Scratchy cartoons are just artless and bad. It just wanton violence. There's nothing clever about it, but everyone still laughs.
Yes. Yeah. The bloody D through the guy is great. It being a bunch of guys lined up by a cop and then shot with Tommy guns, that is what happened in the St. Valentine's Day Massacre in Chicago in 1929. Two of the two of the shooters were wearing police uniforms while the other wore suits, ties, and overcoats. Witnesses saw the men in police uniforms leading the other men at gunpoint out of the garage after the shooting. So there you go. That's why it's funny, because it's true. It is
literally true.
But man, that bloody D on the Cadillac, it's so violent. I'm a little surprised they got away with it.
I mean, I'm amazed they got away with most Itchy and Scratchy, especially in the seasons to come. I mean, I don't know if they got, you know, more latitude after it became, you know, just sort of a darling, but it's insane what they get away with sometimes. I think
also, as a little kid, I thought that champagne waterfall was so cool. I was like, man, that's nice. I've never done it yet, but I feel like in my video games press days, I went to one fancy party once where somebody was doing it, but it always looks cool. And then black-haired Wiggum comes in. Maybe the last time he's got his season one black hair on, I think.
Another character they're figuring out, because he is barely in season two, because they're being very literal about who he is and what he does, because they would think, why would the police chief be on all these routine calls? Why would he be working a beat? He's behind his desk. So we see him running this investigation, and that's where they find all the jokes with him. Before, he is just like an authority figure in the world, but now they can have fun and make him stupid.
It makes sense for Wiggum to, as police chief, that he would get in on these busts, because he thinks it's going to be like big headlines for him if he can arrest Fat Tony. But they realized, I think, with this episode, how funny it is for him to just be with the other cops on any old arrest. And so, like, you know what? Just have him be there. It can't just be Lou, Eddie, and Lou going to the people's house.
And his voice, talking about voices again, like, it's a little more, it still is that sort of Edward G. Robinson. It's more faithful. It's not the complete, like, almost pig-like voice that he eventually gets, and is a little bit more goofy and flanderized, I guess is the term.
I love his line, "Until one of us is behind bars." You.
Like, you.
And I feel like, you know, he takes his free drink, but I feel like, you know, by another season, Wiggum will just be directly taking bribes and not even pretending to want to arrest Fat Tony.
That's another thing, is they develop the, you know, both socially astute and comically superior role for him as a corrupt cop, and that he's just basically never solving crimes. And when he's even approached about it, he's dismissing someone and busy either eating or taking a bribe.
Yeah, he does sound a bit more like the initial impression for Hank Azaria was David Brinkley. And then it transitioned to Edward. Is Edward or Edgar? I always mess that up.
Oh, I think
Edward G. Robinson.
Edward G. Robinson. I love the man. Double Indemnity, great movie. But Mo started out as Al Pacino and then morphed into his own thing. So Hank is having fun, like, evolving these voices.
And I also love the way Fat Tony says to him, "Good for you." Like, that's such a great condescending. Okay, then this cigarette scene, again, this is like Homer perfection. Like, this is Swartzwelder really getting Homer at the level of stupidity that's perfect for him. This and another scene after this are so perfect of, like, Homer thinks he's in a regular sitcom and will not notice how much bigger things are on him now.
Bart! Have you started smoking?
No.
Don't lie to me, boy. Cigarettes, just as I thought.
They're not mine. My boss said his warehouse was full.
Yeah, right. Son, I'm going to teach you a lesson. I'm going to stand here and watch you smoke every one of those cigarettes. Then maybe you'll learn.
Fat Tony sent me over to pick up the goods.
Right in here, my man.
Hey, kid, you look good with that cigarette. Kind of sophisticated.
Son, I'll never doubt you again.
Bart was using the old I'm holding it for a friend lie, but in that case it's true. He actually is.
So great. The way Homer goes, yeah, right. And then I laughed so hard this time when Homer has a clearly labeled carton of cigarettes in front of him. And when he opens the carton and pulls out one pack, he's like, aha, cigarettes, just as I thought. Like, what a great, great line.
There's a mountain of, I guess, all hand-drawn, they say in the commentary, background.
Homer has to squeeze past them. There's so many.
I wish they explained what is written on the back of that guy's jacket. You see the patch on his shoulder is like an okay symbol, and there's like a joke company name written on the back of his jacket.
Yeah.
But you don't actually get to see the entire thing, and I wish they would have said what it was.
Is that his voice? I can't see the video when you're playing the clip. I don't remember does he look like a returning character, or is he just that voice that they sometimes use?
It is the Bronson voice, but it's not the Raphael design, as we've learned his name is in season 12.
Oh, interesting. Okay. Yeah. I love that voice. And I love that line. Kind of sophisticated.
Yeah. What a great thing to tell the kids at home. Like, you look sophisticated.
They slip that in. Like, that's flagrantly telling people telling kids it's cool to smoke.
I also love that Homer says, that he trusts Bart entirely now. And then when it cuts to Bart filing his nails while sitting on the couch, meanwhile, Homer has the blank expression on his face with a beer in his hand, like he is not thinking at all when he sees all this stuff. Like he has no thoughts on Bart and Lisa right in front of him talking about, like, hey, is your boss a mobster? He doesn't care. Homer does not give a shit in this episode. This is the end of press conference Wiggum. Like, I guess he still hosts press conference after this, but like you said, Bob, in season 1 and 2, that's mainly what Wiggum does. He's a press conference guy on TV.
By the end of the season, he's returning Maggie to Homer after she goes missing.
Right.
He really takes a journey down to like beat cop level activities.
And it's so great that to assure the smokers, he just lets the Laramie representative come up and just do a commercial on TV for cigarettes.
They'll be ignoring all stop signs and crosswalks.
Yes, that's so good. And that's Jack Larson, one of his two appearances. He's the also the guy in charge of Laramie in the Lisa Beauty Queen episode.
Oh.
I wish he appeared more. He's a great slime ball character. Like, he's great.
Yeah.
But we hear that this would not stay the same even in classic era Simpsons episodes, but I really love this name of Fat Tony, his real name.
Police suspect the involvement of reputed mobster William Fat Tony Williams.
Fat Tony is a cancer on this fair city. He is the cancer, and I am the... what cures cancer?
Bart, is your boss a crook?
I don't think so. Although it would explain an awful lot.
Me and the boys wish to thank you for hanging on to this stuff for us.
Thanks. Say, are you guys crooks?
Bart, is it wrong to steal a loaf of bread to feed your starving family?
No.
Well, suppose you got a large starving family. Is it wrong to steal a truckload of bread to feed them?
Uh-uh.
And what if your family don't like bread? They like cigarettes.
I guess that's okay.
Now, what if instead of giving them away, you sold them at a price that was practically giving them away? Would that be a crime, Bart?
Hell no.
Enjoy your gift.
That's so great. He so directly describes a crime to Bart, and Bart goes like, hell no. Like, that's so good.
He's a good salesman. He's a persuasive guy.
And, in Many Saints of Newark, there's a very similar scene of this, of not to this extent, but of Dickie Moltisanti explains to a young Tony Soprano how you compartmentalize things and just say to yourself, like, oh, well, just tell yourself this is the last time I steal anything like this. Mm-hmm. Just tell yourself that and you do it. Yeah, I just love Bart's, that would explain an awful lot. And also his reaction shot is, again, just great little animation there.
He's using the Embry board.
Yes, yeah. I wish they'd have stuck with it, but I mean, his later name would be Fat Tony D'Amico, but that his name is William Williams, which, you know, if in the world of the mafia, he would instantly be called like Billy Will or Willie Will or something like
Big Bill.
Any type of name that would have to do with such a perfect name as William Williams. But then they call him Fat Tony. Like, there's a story there. I just love, there's an untold story there of how he got that name.
So I didn't realize that they changed his name. That's too bad. Was that that when he reappears in Homie the Clown, or is that even later?
I believe it is in Homer They Fall in season 8. Okay. He's Michael Buffer introduces him as Fat Tony D'Amico. Hmm.
Yeah, that's sort of stepping away from a joke, because like D'Amico isn't a joke. That's just an Italian name. Why, you know, like it's I get that it would scan, you know, more easily for people, but don't get rid of your funny joke.
It's more of a Bill and Josh thing of just like, well, what's a boring name for?
Yeah.
Like, what is a boring but unknown Italian name? Like, D'Amico, let's go with that. And yeah, you know, the stealing of the cigarettes and reselling them, that is what Henry Hill gets in trouble for at the start of Goodfellas. So again,
yep. With the miniature Joe Pesci, he does it.
That's right.
Yeah, and it's his graduation day, just like Bart. He's, you know, he stayed strong selling the cigarettes, and that's when he gets his suit.
It's funny, that, again, the things they borrow directly are not the most memorable things from the movie.
They do the you look like a gangster moment with Marge and a Bart, but yeah. Which, you know, is a memorable moment, but not nobody repeats, you look like a gangster.
Although, frankly, Goodfellas is so chock full of quotable and or memorable moments that it's one of those movies where you can just take your pick. You know, there's so many good things. But I like that they didn't, I guess it was so contemporaneous that maybe they didn't even know what was going to be totally memeified at the time, although you're probably right, the Joe Pesci stuff was obviously, you know, the thing everyone was tapping into. But I wish that they you know, I wish a lot of things about the later seasons, but like it's refreshing that they're not going for those low-hanging fruits. It's kind of that's what you would want them to do, is eschew that. But then, as we talked about last time, you know, by the time they're doing, say, the In Sync episode, it's like Matrix gag, you know, where they're flying in the air, like all the stuff that is 9 months late, you know, in general. This is like the opposite of that, which is kind of interesting.
Bart asked for 3 fingers of milk, which as a kid, I had to, my mom had to explain to me that is an old-timey measurement of alcohol, that it goes up to the height of your fingers. This is another just great, very Swartzwelder-y scene of Marge being like, I'm a little worried, but about something entirely ridiculous.
I know it's good for a boy to have a part-time job, but I'm not sure about the people Bart's working for. I think they're criminals.
A job's a job. I mean, take me. If my plant pollutes the water and poisons the town, by your logic, that would make me a criminal.
Well, Bart's been acting very strangely. And that pizza delivery truck has been parked across the street for 2 weeks. How long does it take to deliver a pizza?
Looks like our cover's blown.
Let's roll.
See? It was all your imagination.
Homer, I want you to go down to that club and talk to them. Let's see what kind of people they are. Please, homie.
Oh, all right.
Flowers by Irene. What great. That also does feel like a Goodfellas parody, because like that film perfectly captures the feeling of like, wait, is that helicopter? Is that it? Like just that paranoia. Yeah. And yeah, also just, I love Homer's like, by your logic, that would make me a criminal.
Homer is ready for the internet.
It's true. Yeah. Also, just as the car drives away, as Marge was saying that, Homer goes, see, it was all your imagination. Like, what a great shitty Homer, it's like jerk Homer line.
Yeah. Yeah.
So Homer, I guess Homer made a few $100 winning that that card game that they let him win. I guess that's part of their bribery, which this is, you know, similar to, well, actually, they get a little more direct with the mafia getting involved in a boy's life thing from Goodfellas. But I think it works fine. Them saying, Homer, you're a hell of a father, and just Homer being satisfied, that works enough. Like, I think Al Jean was second guessing things too much of like, no, we need some scene of Homer and Marge resolving that Homer's not worried about it anymore. And so they just take out the ending shot from Lisa's substitute and put new dialogue over it. I don't know. Do you guys think it's needed? Like,
there are some things in here that aren't needed. I think they're still thinking in the old way of writing the show, being too literal, trying to justify things. The scene coming up with Burns and Smithers, I feel like they're trying to justify a crazy choice they would just let happen at the end of the season.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think you're totally right about that, Henry.
I think, we talk about, I fear that Al Jean second guesses himself too much in his later era of the show, but I think a little of that even is in the classic seasons like this. But, and then also,
I agree with you, Bob. I think it's just sort of like a transitory thing where they're moving out of an old style of formal conflict resolution or plot, or like beating out stuff that they would certainly go on to at times go out of their way to ignore those things, but here they're still somewhat tailored to them.
And they then call back to Bart the Genius with an I am the wiener, I am a wiener spray painting of Skinner on the wall. I like that Bart tries to bribe him and that he just completely rejects this. Very, very similar to Henry Hill getting a beating at home when his school narcs on him that he's not been to school in months. And
yep.
Except in this case, they don't beat up a postman.
No, they try to have a very nice meeting with Skinner.
Yes.
And he's the aggressive one, which I love that twist coming up.
So Bart has to stay for detention and write on the chalkboard. We then cut to the big mafia meeting. This is the most like direct Godfather 2 stuff in the episode. Not only the kiss of death, but that Hartman is absolutely parodying Frankie Five Angels, the actor Michael Gazzo from Godfather Part 2, which, what have I done to like, what? Yeah. When I finally watched Godfather Part 2 after seeing this as a kid, I was like, oh, that's why everybody talks with his raspy voice. What I do?
For that's very good, actually.
That's really good, Henry.
I'm a master of voices.
For Blowback Season 2, little shameless plug, we did a movie episode about bad movies made about Cuba. And one of them was kind of like a sleazy, almost trauma level film called, it had two titles. One was, funnily enough, one of them was Sweet Dirty Tony, and it was the name of it. The other one was called Cuba Crossing, a little bit more boring. But Michael Gazzo is in that, like in the later part of his career, probably not that much later. But the things that make that a strong voice and performance in the Godfather movies make it incredibly grating and hard to deal with in any other not very good movie. But yes, this is definitely a Godfather direct, like Godfather reference here.
That's a great episode of your podcast with Bill Corbett on it.
Yeah, Bill Corbett from Mystery Science Theater, I should say. Yeah, go check it out if you want to hear about bad Cuba cinema.
And so, they give the job of mixing Manhattans to Louis instead, and, well, doesn't go so well.
So, Fat Tony, you invite me and my associates to your club with the promise of the finest Manhattans in all of Springfield. Now you say your bartender isn't here?
I don't know what happened. He's never late. Louis, make up some Manhattans.
But I only know how to make wine spritzes.
No.
What have I done to deserve this flat, flavorless Manhattan? Come on, boys.
The kiss of death. That's all I need.
You know, credit to Phil Hartman. Whenever I see a Manhattan on a menu, I think of him saying that.
You don't want a dry, flavorless Manhattan. It's worth killing over if you're given a crappy Manhattan.
And a wine spritzer is just wine and soda water.
Yeah,
it's just like,
that's easy to do.
Anyone can do this. It's what got Ned wasted.
That's right. The
wussiest. You love spritzers.
Yeah.
The mafia does love them. It's funny, but it's also true. I love spritzers.
It just is the way he walks off. The guy playing Jax, like, that feels like a very Swartzwelder script direction kind of thing too. and so yes the mobsters, fortunately for Fat Tony, he is not killed over this, and he continues to live in the series. But this is not Don Vittorio DiMaggio. I would guess behind the scenes this Phil Hartman voice guy gets replaced and taken over, usurped,
or
by Don
waxed.
Vittorio. Oh yes, yeah. And Bart then tells them that it's because Principal Skinner made him stay. Like, oh, well, really? This, again, very quick scene, but their confrontation with Skinner, this is such perfect Skinner here.
You are late for work.
Of course I'm late for work. How can I be on time when Principal Skinner keeps me after school?
This guy Skinner causing you trouble?
He sure is, Patron.
Perhaps we should go to meet and greet this individual. Come on, boys.
Mm.
some large men to see you, sir.
I don't have an appointment with any large men.
You Skinner.
I'm Principal Skinner, yes. And how, may I ask, did you get past the hall monitors?
That's just
one of the top five lines, maybe of Skinner in general for me. I don't have an appointment with any large.
There's so much great lighting in this episode. For no reason, Skinner is just sitting in a dark room. So when the door opens, it's like noir lighting spread across him, like this big like.
Maybe he's having a Vietnam flashback.
such a great little cut there too of like, oh, this man's murdered. Like, this is the assumption you're jumping to there, and just though his secretary would be a witness to the murder. I guess they're going to escort him out and kill him somewhere else. That's the
never go to a second location.
Yes, that you're right. You're right. Oh, and a little thing I meant to mention too. Another little tiny thing I love animation wise is when Fat Tony is watching his boss drink. Like, he kind of purses his lips out of like that. He's that's how much he's like, oh, what's he drinking? Like, what a great little thing. Like, so good. But yes, this is when in the very next scene, Edna Krabappel comes in crying. She's more emotional than usual in this episode, and
they're planting the seeds that will blossom years later.
This is when she announces to the kids that he's missing. All the kids yell in excitement, even Martin, which feels, you know, and Martin shouldn't be. He should be concerned about
this. He shouldn't. Yeah. I, for a second in my head, thought, because this is one of my favorite scenes, is this when Skinner is cracking open the door and says a boking accident? Like, I was just crossing my wires, but it did remind me that this is not the last time poor Seymour Skinner is going to have a run-in with the mob, although I guess the second time he actually is successfully captured and tortured.
They get directly violent with him in that one. Yes. Yeah.
He's not as stern. I guess his spirit has been whittled down by that point, and they actually successfully get the better of him.
So the next act of the episode begins with Wiggum starting the search. He has the most advanced scientific techniques in the field of body finding. I also like just a great gag of them fishing the scuba diver out, and then Skinner having to look at the picture of Seymour first to be sure it's not him. Willie talks to the media, and then we get one of two appearances by Princess Opal. I wish this fortune teller appeared more in the series. She's funny.
Speaking of like finding characters and characters emerging, Willie returning from his first appearance.
Yeah, you're right.
The second speaking appearance.
First return.
Yeah.
Wow.
Last seen in Principal Charming in mid-season 2, they assumed they would never use him again, but here he is.
Man, yeah.
I guess I always think of season 3 as when things took a step up as far as the style and the tone, but I didn't realize that so many signature characters had only appeared once or twice until that season, and it was also like a universe building thing as well.
Yeah, the break between 2 and 3, I think, gave them the writers a real chance to appraise, like, well, we saw what worked and what didn't in pretty much every episode would have been done by then, or at least in some level of completion, so they could say, like, oh, well, this is the thing that works better. Like, and Willie's very funny once we finally see his ridiculous look and crazy face. But Sam, I wish they thought Princess Opal was as funny, because her one joke is in this episode. And there's not much more to it, but let's hear some of her predictions.
Please, I can assure you we'll be using the most advanced scientific techniques in the field of body finding.
I see wedding bells for Vanna White and Teddy Kennedy.
Please, Princess Opal, if we could just stick to Principal Skinner.
Chief Wiggum, I am merely a conduit for the spirits. Willie Nelson will astound his fans by swimming the English Channel.
Really? Willie Nelson?
He loved fire drills.
Will you get a hold of yourself, lass, for the wee bairns?
Hey, look at me. I'm Skinner's body.
That is not funny, Lewis.
Well, I heard Skinner's buried under his parking spot.
Well, I heard he was ground up into hamburger and served to us at lunch.
I heard Bart and Skinner killed by gangsters.
That's not true. It's just a rumor. You're engaged in speculation. I know the law. You can't prove anything.
I love how Wiggum easily gets on board with just being entertained by these celebrity predictions. Yeah. Just like, oh, really? Wow. Brendan, sorry.
That's a flash of future Wiggum a bit there, like just suddenly being bamboozled. so here's a question. Are are we to think that Nelson, maybe from his being on the wrong side of the law, of elementary school law at least, that's how he actually is savvy to Bart's involvement? Or is that just purely a gag, like that could have been any kid coming up with the exact right answer for where Skinner has probably gone?
You know, if it was Milhouse saying it, that'd be another thing. But yeah, I think you're right that this is the bad kid saying it. Maybe he has a little intel, you know? Maybe Nelson's
I wouldn't
with
have
the
thought about it, except that it's Nelson. Like, it's Nelson for presumably for a reason. Maybe it's not. I
think
know.
So, yeah.
You know, with his name Munz, then he must be in with, like, a German gang, a German immigrant gang as well. But
yeah, he's well, and Nelson's, does Nelson have a dad? Was his dad like dad?
Oh, he's got a couple dad.
Yeah.
There's two different versions of Nelson's dad.
His dad has a lot of lore. His dad appears at the beginning of Brother from the Same Planet as the soccer coach.
Right. Yeah, he picks Nelson, and yeah, I remember that.
And then he disappears, and then much later in the teens, I believe, they do the return of Nelson's dad.
Mm-hmm. And then he was instead a deadbeat dad who, like, abandoned his mom for her addiction to cough syrup, I believe it was. And yeah, you know, Teddy Kennedy gone, but Vanna White, as big a star as ever on Wheel of Fortune every night. Everybody loves her.
Did you see that clip the other day of the people not getting another feather in your cap? That made me go insane.
That was that's the point of Wheel of Fortune, is to drive you insane. Not to feel, it's, you know, you watch Jeopardy, you feel dumber than the competitors. If you watch Wheel of Fortune, you're supposed to feel smarter than them. It's that's why it's a great combo of shows. No, that I think that what's so funny in that clip was, in the feather in your cap one, there's one guy who definitely knows it, and twice he hits bankrupt, so he can't guess it, and so it has it keeps
awesome.
Going to the two idiots who don't know it.
The Simpsons did that joke, like, last season. Three loins in the fountain.
That's right. That's
instead of
right.
three coins in the fountain. So even back then, they were aware of how frustrating that was.
That's great.
The timelessness of Wheel of Fortune. It's but
Pat Sajak also, I'm surprised he hasn't, like, gone on a rant that will get his career cut short, because he's a big right winger.
Yeah, Pat isn't Sajak. That funny that, like, it always feels like he's about to be on the Chuck Woolery level, but I think he's got some handlers who are just able to keep him at, like, the Chris Pratt level of acceptable famous Republican. You know, just
I mean that's, if there ever was a golden goose for a man of Pat Sajak's talent, it's like, don't screw with the Wheel of Fortune gig. Just his handlers, they must be begging him to not go there.
He's not going to implode like Gina Carano, you know. He's smart. He knows where the money's at. But
exactly.
Also, man, that slap on Edna, like, it's like I think it's actually very well animated, like the way it is. But it's intense to see Willie just slap. I mean, it's like from a 1940s movie, which is why Swartzwelder put it in there. Like, you slap a hysterical woman. That's what you do.
Not in front of the Bairns.
Yeah, the Bairns.
Yeah, but I do find it funny when the kid is like, "Look, I'm Skinner's body." It's just such a funny thing. For like even a fourth grader to be making fun of, is just like, I'm our principal's corpse. You know, isn't this fun, guys?
It's a great observable kid thing that they'd be like, oh, I'll pretend to be a decapitated body by putting leaves over my head. Like, that's such a funny thing.
That and Bart ripping his pants are the juvenile bits of the episode that I genuinely really laughed hard at.
And then we have a very season one thing of a minute long dream sequence. Like, and I think it is executed perfectly. Like, so many great, like, animation bits here. Like, not a ton of great lines, a couple, but yeah, just like Bart coming across zombie Skinner in so many different spots, like, so good.
And
like,
the meat locker Skinner, that's how Frank dies in the in Goodfellas. I mean, he's in a truck, but there's meat hanging.
Yeah, it's the meat hanging, which again, that has to, I'm not saying, you know, people weren't, the bodies weren't left on meat hooks in other movies before that, but him being a frozen body in a meat locker is in his suit is a Goodfellas reference. There's no two ways about that.
A good, another good version of that, I believe, is Road Games, if anyone wants a lesser known classic. Stacy Keach, who was in Gotti, in a much better film with Jamie Lee Curtis called Road Games, where a killer puts a bunch of people in a freezer truck with hooks.
Ooh.
Earlier than Goodfellas. Yeah, I was going to say, say the shot of Skinner coming out of the locker is so squiggly, it almost reminded me of Home Movies. It could have been a frame from Home Movies there.
It was approaching squiggle vision levels.
Yeah, exactly.
And then there's a great design of where Bart's in jail in the death house in big neon. Like, that's so great.
Love that.
And Bob's got it as his background, but Homer chanting "Kill my boy," what a great
with no real lip sync, just "Kill my boy."
That's something that in this season, as much as they're getting Homer in the show, is still a dream sequence. In a couple seasons, that would just be taking place in reality. Homer would just get swept up and then actually be advocating everyone to kill his son.
Homer sort of becomes this character in court when he turns on Bart, though. Like, oh, it's all true. Yeah.
In a way, he does kill Bart. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. That's another, I guess I will wait for it, but that is another one of my favorite lines in this episode coming in that scene.
And I love Lovejoy in Bart's dream comforting him with, "They're there. They're there.
They're there."
And Bart being electrocuted is kind of funny, but the Deep, Deep Trouble music video does animate Bart being sent to the electric chair a little funnier, so it's hard for me not to think of that as a better bit. But they had a bigger budget. It was music video budget on that. I understand why. But Bart's jump out of bed and scream, that's great. I know they say it on the commentary, but I don't think so. I mean, okay, yes. A guy screaming and then a cut to an establishing shot of a house, that is a Godfather Horsehead reference, but they do so much more explicit Horsehead jokes, like 17 of them, it feels in the history of the series.
There's one this just around the corner, too, with Lisa's Pony.
Maybe after they like halfway do it in this episode, once they get to Lisa's Pony, they're like, let's go all the way. Let's just go all the way with the Horsehead bit. And so Bart comes in early for work in this next scene.
You're 8 hours early for work. I like that.
Did you kill my principal?
Chinese guy with a mustache?
No, my principal!
That Skinner guy? No, we didn't kill him. Nobody more. You're all under arrest for the murder of Seymour Skinner.
What's a murder?
Don't play. Come with me. Cuff him, boys.
Oh, Bart. Why couldn't you have gotten a paper rule like other boys?
Wait till I get you home, boy.
What's that guy doing here?
Lionel Hutz, court-appointed attorney. I'll be defending you on the charge of murder one. Wow, even if I lose, I'll be famous.
You know, not enough of Hutz being a bad lawyer, but he wasn't as crazy as he would be at this point in the show.
Yeah, but this is them getting him. Like, this again, when Bill and Josh, I think, especially write him so well in their season 4 episodes, but they're referencing really how he's written in this one more than in in the previous part, gets hit by a car. Yeah.
Yeah. Because, I mean, there's not a lot of screen time for him, but murder won. And at the end where he goes, do I still get paid?
Yeah.
It's like classic Hutz.
I also really laughed hard this time at Homer saying, wait till I get you home, boy, because this is him thinking he's in a season 1 episode where it's like, you're not taking Bart home. He's in jail for denied bail. Like, this is bad.
Yeah.
Chinese guy with a mustache. I choose to believe that's a reference to the Cassavetes mobster film, The Killing of a Chinese Bookie. That's what It must be. I do believe the guy who gets shot in the hot tub in that movie does have a mustache. The spoilers in that film, a Chinese bookie is killed, but that's not really the plot of the film. It's a pretty aimless movie, in a Cassavetes way, but I like it. But
The scene with Burns and Smithers, they love Burns and Smithers. They want to work them into everything at this point in the show, but it feels like they feel the next idea is so crazy, they need to have a character comment on, like, can you believe it, Smithers? They're doing this.
It's
Act 3.
Though it feels weird for Burns to be the guy who's like, people are too crazy with the trying children as adults. Which, boy, this was a depressing thing to search, guys. Guess what? There's been several people since this Simpsons episode who were 12 or 13 or 11 tried for first degree murder in America. And the 4 stories I could find, when I searched the wonderful search term of youngest person first degree murder, they were all in 1999. These three cases. One of the cases had two defendants, 112, 113, another 11 in 1999. Two of them were in Florida. One was in Michigan. And yeah, it's depressing. And I bet you guys can guess a unifying similarity in all four of these people who were tried as adults despite being children in America. I bet you can guess. Yes, they're all African American. Okay. That is the reason. Like, yes, they are tried as, like, they're horrible stories. You can look them up if you want to, but it's just tragic things of people that failed the system. Like, yeah. So unfortunately, when Burns jokes that, like, could you believe this would happen in America? Like, no, it happened all the time.
I guess for that reason alone, there's a bit of added value, you know, social commentary to what was otherwise kind of like an unnecessary little shot.
Yeah. Yeah. It's though now you see, now it's so routine. Like, those lawyers didn't become famous, but,
Yeah.
Though I suppose if they were white children like Bart, maybe so.
Yeah,
perhaps so. Instead of
funny that I was watching it and I didn't know that was reused, but it's kind of like subconsciously I did. Like, I didn't even remember that scene with Smithers and Burns. I just sort of it felt so like tangential. I forgot that was even in the episode, so I don't even remember what they said.
I was thinking, speaking of minors being tried for murder, Kyle Rittenhouse, did his lawyers become famous or were they already famous?
Yeah, I think it was the famous lawyers already.
Okay.
And he's certainly on the touring ticket. He's touring around too. Well, that's a difference too, because he was found not guilty, as opposed to all the people I mentioned there. They were found guilty. Some of them, one of them went to jail for 5 years and then was released on appeal. Two of them went to jail for 15 years and were released in 2014. Insane to me. And again, 12 and 13. Even in the cases like where it is an open and shut case of guilt, in that, like, they're children. This is not it's a bummer. I don't want to talk about it anymore. but yes, okay.
And they're definitely not put in the same cell with adults.
No, and certainly not with a giant buff Sideshow Bob as well, which honestly looks like someone's fetish art. Honestly, of like,
which is also weird because that. You know, Bart and him are not nemesis yet. It's kind of a strange. I'm sure they were. Obviously, they didn't know that was all going to unspool the way it did. But it's weird. It's a weird moment just because of what we know will happen.
Yeah, when he comes back in Black Widower, Bart's like, "We were sellies, right? Remember?"
Yeah.
No, he doesn't reference it.
No, he doesn't reference it. No.
Yeah. Okay. But yes, after a brief clip of Brush with Greatness and Burns and Smithers talking, it's then people take to the stand. Also pretty similar to the end of Goodfellas, of Fat Tony is basically Henry Hill on the stand pointing at pointing at his boss, except he points at Bart.
I didn't order this Skinner guy killed.
But aren't you the head of this gang?
No, I just stop by the club occasionally to read the complimentary newspaper.
Then who is the kingpin, the capo di tutti capi?
That's the guy.
Hey!
Forgive me, Don Bartholomew.
We tried to stop the kid, but he wouldn't quit. It was like he went crazy.
Prostitution, loan sharking, numbers. The kid liked the wettest bleak and everything.
Mr. Simpson, you've been the boy's father for 10 years. Do you really think he could be the leader of a murderous criminal syndicate?
Well, not the leader, I mean. Oh, it's true, it's true. All the pieces fit.
Now, if this was real life, Bart would never forgive his father ever for doing this to him.
I really just think that is one of my favorite Homer lines, is not the leader. Like, you know, of course he's probably mixed up in organized crime, but he's not that bad. I that's just perfectly delivered.
It's also funny hearing blue-haired lawyers say capo di tutti capi, like such a
yeah.
And there's a fun little inside joke that's on the commentary. Rich Moore talks about the bad sketch the artist is drawing of Bart. Apparently that was a Bart that someone had drawn for them in a submission packet to work on the show.
Oh
my god. I mean, even the effort, like the attention to put in that gag at the time, it's like every possible opening, you know, they would use, even though no one, like, it's only because I listened to the commentary and or appeared on the show that I would ever learn that, but it's cool that they did that.
just them taking a swipe at an artist who, like, probably at home was like, wait, what? They do that? No, I'm also surprised that the Fox lawyers kept that in there, because it almost sounds like a lawyer would be like, this is might open us up to a lawsuit of us, like, this artist could sue that we used his art without paying him.
That's an interesting point. I guess they got lucky, maybe. But they didn't shout out the artist's name and say, hey, this guy sucks.
Yeah, so, that's true. And also another inside joke, Fat Tony's prison number, 8FO3. That's the episode code for the production of this one. So, yeah, they show the chart with Bart at the top. It was a Godfather reference, but now I can't not think of Sopranos. That has a very prominent chart in it as well.
With the song by Exhibit.
Yeah. Yes. And you know, when Legs wipes his nose and says wet his beak and everything, that's the bit where it really reminded me of Tony Cicero / Polly Walnuts. That's the one. But I also love in the newspaper, the editorial drawing of Bart is like the Standard Oil octopus holding everything in his tentacles. That's so great too.
Yeah.
After I've read all those depressing stories about actual children in court, seeing tiny little Bart in chains with the judge looking above him, a little less funny to me. It's just more tragic, but it's a great drawing.
Mm-hmm.
And yes, as Bart is about to be sentenced, Skinner reveals himself.
Stop! Principal Skinner!
I thought he was dead.
I suppose you're all wondering where I've been. It all started a week ago. I was at my desk revising and updating the school dress codes when I was suddenly confronted by a gang of toughs acting on behalf of one Bart Simpson, or so they said.
We really think there's promise in a boy.
Get out!
Okay, you don't have to yell.
To get my mind off that ugly confrontation, I went home and began bundling my old newspapers. But suddenly the pile fell. I was trapped. Let this be a lesson to recycle frequently. For the next week, I stayed alive by eating my mother's delicious preserves and maintained my sanity by dribbling a nearby basketball with my one free hand. I made a game of it, seeing how many times I could bounce the ball in a day, then trying to break that record. Occasionally, the police arrived to search my home.
Find anything this time, boys?
No sign of it, Chief.
Princess Opal?
I see nothing here, but I'm afraid it's Splitsville for Delta Burke and Major Dad.
But they seem so happy.
Every time you say that makes me laugh.
We checked in on it last time, but it's true this time as well. Gerald McRaney and Delta Burke happily married since 1989.
Take that, you know. All these people thought, I wouldn't bet on any Hollywood marriage lasting, any single one.
And to put us in the early 90s, we get references to Major Dad and MacGyver.
Yes, yeah. We talk about it a ton in the later seasons, in the teens, but this is so true for this. Like, they say that this came in pretty late in the third act writing, and it actually is like such a, it is a very Simpsony thing of, they have written themselves into a corner, but there's the only logical explanation is Skinner is definitely dead and murdered by the mafia, and so he has to then explode into the room and it becomes a completely different episode and just a lengthy parody of a MacGyver series.
They had a real bone to pick with MacGyver, which was at this point entering its final season. It would be a plot point in Black Widower. Patty and Selma defined as MacGyver fans, and Richard Dean Anderson would even appear on the show in 2006. Patty and Selma hold him hostage in the episode Kiss Kiss Bang Bangalore, and of course we all know this best through the parody MacGruber,
of course,
but there was a MacGyver reboot. It ran for 100 episodes from 2016 to 2021. I think they were trying to take it back from MacGruber.
Unbelievable to me, man.
Because MacGruber, it's really just the name. He doesn't do MacGyvery things.
That's true.
I love that movie. I don't know if the new show is good. I'm sure
it rules. It rules. If you love the movie, watch the new show. It rules.
Okay, yeah. I was like, the movie is one of those movies where, like, there's no reason this should be good. You know, it's like, it should be like a passable SNL spinoff movie, but Will Forte is just so amazing and they get an amazing cast. But the name is almost misleading because he's not a MacGyver parody.
Right. It's just the aesthetic, right? The MacGyver aesthetic.
Yeah, and it could be any 80s action hero, though, I think, as well. It's, I think, just like Decker.
At the end of the movie, he does one thing MacGyver-y. He MacGyvers together one thing. But the sketches were invented, it was MacGyver is about to put a shoelace with a piece of gum or whatever, but then he acts stupid and gets distracted by it. They go like, MacGruber, we've got 10 seconds. Okay. It definitely was a MacGyver parody very directly in the original sketches. Yeah.
And all the sketches were like 90 seconds long, right?
Yes. Yeah.
You're right about that. I'm not enough of an SNL head to remember that it was based off MacGyver initially, but yeah, I guess they just I love this whole sequence with Skinner. It makes me laugh every time. I especially love, which I forgot, that it's a callback to the beginning of the episode where he is, because when you first watch it, you're like, oh, maybe Skinner's just like coming up with something, almost maybe even mean-spiritedly to tell Bart to do. But no, he really does love the idea of whenever you're in a tough spot, make a game out of it and see if you can get your score higher every time. And I totally forgot it was a callback to the beginning of the episode. Makes it even better.
I love his little look at Bart when he says that, like, eh? See?
Yes, he looks right at him like, see? I wasn't just fucking with you. That's a good thing to do.
And Bart rolls his eyes like, oh, God. Yeah, it's...
I love when he ends with, that's my courageous story.
Yes, yeah. And everybody applauds. Like, God. I just love, too, that they're tearing apart his home over and over again. Like, Skinner says they go there more than once, and they never look in the garage.
The drinking of his beer and eating of his food is really nice too.
I'm in here. Well, let's go. God. Yep. It's also good. But again, this is so wacky town. Like, one, the mafia has to act in a way that they've never acted the whole rest of the episode, of like, hey, oh, don't need to yell. And then they have to, the police have to be so stupid that they have missed him in his own garage for 2 weeks. Like, it's, which is perfect. Like, though, you know, they're not talking about, if this was a season 12 joke or 13, they would talk about Skinner having to relieve himself while under that pile of newspapers as well.
Absolutely.
There would be something scatological in there. But another of my favorite, like, one-word lines ever in Simpsons in this next quick clip.
I formed a crude rocket from a discarded cigar tube. And remembering an experiment from my days as a fourth grade science teacher, I concocted a fuel from baking soda and the juice of discarded lemon wedges. The rocket took off with a mighty blast of carbon dioxide, striking behind it the end of a vacuum cleaner cord. I grabbed onto the vacuum cleaner, pushed the cord retractor button, and was on my way to freedom. That's my courageous story.
Your Honor, the prosecution moves the Principal Skinner's testimony be stricken from the record.
Denied! Casey Smith!
Your Honor, do I still get paid?
What a gambit from, what, the district attorney?
Yes.
Let's just forget that this man is alive. How about that?
You know, it works sometimes in the Law and Order show. Characters will say that.
That's the same attorney from Krusty Gets Busted. It's like, it's the one with the B on it.
You're right, yeah. He must be the boss, and blue-haired lawyer just works for him in this case. But, man, I just, the way Judge, later he'll be called Judge Snyder, just goes, denied! Like, just so good.
I love that, too. I have that in my little one page of notes here. I just the word denied in all caps is so great.
And then they come to what I think in a season 2 episode would just be the ending, which works perfectly fine, of like Bart says the very, like, you know, obvious moral to the story, crime doesn't pay, and then he sees that actually it pays very well for these mobsters and they completely undercut the moral. That would work great as a season 2 ending, but they need a little something extra for this season 3 now. Again, this is them leveling up, but just I also really love the pacing of when Fat Tony says, yeah, you're right. And he gets in his limousine, Legs and Louie walk off screen, and then the two limos drive past. Like, that's so good.
And on his limousine, there's a bumper sticker saying Mafia Staff Car. If we go back to Treehouse of 401, Homer's wearing Mafia Staff Apron. Apparently, that kind of merch was popular around the time Godfather 3 came out.
It's crazy. I had no clue.
Like, Mafia Staff themed, like, bumper sticker or, like, shirt or whatever.
Was Paramount just PR department just giving that out for free to the comedy writers back then?
I feel like these are all just bootlegs. Like, hey, you like Mafia stuff? Well, we got Ninja Turtle Bart, but here's Mafia Staff t-shirt.
Ninja Turtle Bart for your
kids. If they cut the Bart getting splashed sequential gag to make room for the limos sequential gag, I guess I'm glad they did.
And even a good trade. Yeah.
It's a similar joke, and it made me laugh that, I was expecting the scene to be over. Like you say, then you're just like, there's another limo, and they're all riding limos. Every single member of the crew has a giant limo.
But then comes a perfect fourth wall shattering ending, which also works great. And it is the Gene and Reese special for The Critic as well. Like, this is pretty much a scene from The Critic, and I mean that as a compliment. And also, like, Rich Moore was the series director on The Critic, and he's the director of this episode. But let's have one final clip here of Blood on the Blackboard.
Blood on the Blackboard, the Bart Simpson story. Starring Richard Chamberlain as Principal Skinner, Joe Mantegna as Fat Tony, Jane Seymour as the woman he loved, and TV's Doogie Howser, Neil Patrick Harris, as Bart Simpson.
Bart, I'm scared. Let's get out of here.
Shut up! Where do you want it, Skinner? Not smart.
Hey, when do we get to check for this?
Well, they said they changed it just enough so they don't have to pay us.
Oh, you know who the real crooks are. Those sleazy Hollywood producers.
Frank Carbone vindicated.
Yep. Yeah.
That
yeah.
Last joke. That's exactly his problem.
I was thinking of that after I looked up the history of him suing the show. It's like, maybe he saw the end of this episode and he was like, you know what? Homer's right.
Yeah. I got
it. Oh my God. They admit it.
I like how, like, in the writing of this promo within the universe, they realize, like, Neil Patrick Harris is stunt casting. So they have to say, TV's Doogie Howser. Like,
yeah.
Ooh, don't you want to see him play a bad boy?
Oh, so good. And that's.
I also like how the Shearer voice is very drama, you know, crime story, but then for Doogie Howser, he gets a little bit more. He kind of like hurt a little bit when he says Doogie Howser. It's more fun, and then he goes back into crime voice.
Yeah. Woman he loves and Doogie Howser. Yeah, yeah. That's the, yeah.
If you would have asked me, was Neil Patrick Harris ever on The Simpsons? I would have said no, because I always forget the episode ends with this.
Yeah, yeah. I'm still shocked with Neil Patrick Harris, who has been a constant in our lives, like pretty much famous. Our entire lives. I mean, there was like a low point of like, oh, he's famous, and then he's a little less famous, and then he comes back, and it's, you know, he's the internet's own Neil Patrick Harris. But he's, in all that time, never again on The Simpsons. I was sure if I looked it up, I'd be like, oh, in season 28, he came in and did not. He's never been on the show since then, which is crazy to me. And my opinion on MPH is, yes, I think he's a bit extra. He's a bit of an online liberal celebrity, but I like him in stuff. I really liked him in Matrix Resurrections. Like, I love that one of the most evil things to Lana Wachowski is a sellout cis homosexual white man. Like, that's so great to me. I love that. But yeah, he would have been 17 or 18 at the time he recorded this. And ironically enough, 6 months after this aired, he would be the lead in Capital Critters, the Simpsons ripoff show.
Yep. Oh, you reminded me of Capital Critters, Henry. Yeah. We did an episode about that for our other podcast. It was one of the most painful things we've ever covered.
Yeah.
I've never even like glanced at Capital Critters.
It's all on YouTube and it sucks, but you can watch it. Look up our What a Cartoon on Capital Critters, especially if you're a Simpsons fan. I think you'll learn a lot about how it only exists because of The Simpsons. And Stephen Bochco thought it would be easy to copy The Simpsons and make, and you know, he got a bunch of money, I'm sure. But anyway, Joe Mantegna playing himself, that's great. I also think,
yep,
Richard Chamberlain for 1991, that's great casting for Seymour Skinner. Perfect. Perfect.
It's also it's something I'll never quite get. And even listening to the commentary, why is it okay, you know, that there was concern over Bart joining a gang? Why was it okay for a popular, you know, young person on TV to then cap someone five times in a row with a gun? Like, okay, they don't show the literal corpse, you know, get riddled with bullets, but they did show that earlier on Itchy and Scratchy. But like, it's just funny to me, like, where these lines were and why certain things were permissible.
I also love the design of Neil Patrick Harris wearing Bart's costume and his hair is up in the Bart yeah. points. Like, it's yeah. it's a great character model for him too. Yeah,
all reenactments in that eighth season run are great. You know, the one in Homer Badman is actually one of my favorites that we mentioned earlier with,
yeah,
it's a living being, I don't care. It's just one of my favorite lines.
With a man in the White House.
I miss the era of
not likely.
Like a provocative title, The Blank Story. So yeah. Homer's was Portrait of an Ass Grabber.
yes. Yes.
It's too bad. You know, the TV movie world, it's different now. You know, it's the rip from the headline stuff. Well, I guess technically, like, there's just about to be that Elizabeth Holmes movie thing. So these things do happen, but it's not, the speed isn't as much. Like, there's usually about 10 years.
Yeah.
And they're not as trashy and fun. Like, that one looks very pristinely made and all that. Like, the I was just thinking the last era of that where there were jokes to do about it, it reminds me of Arrested Development in the early 2000s with the Tobias, "Methinks an attic I shall seek."
Right, right.
You know, running dramatization.
Also a perfect parody of Fox programming, especially. Like, both took great swings at Fox.
The one you're right. Yeah.
The one I can think of that's similar to this, but you're right. They have like a prestige TV sheen to them now, but there's the recent one about Joe Exotic, which I heard is okay.
Yeah, that one.
And there's like a Pam and Tommy one. They're still kind of doing these for...
They do happen.
Well, yeah, but that's like looking back, though.
Yeah.
Pam and Tommy, you know. Yeah.
I guess the Joe Exotic one is pretty as much more recent, yeah.
Yeah, though I think with all of those, and same with the Elizabeth Holmes one, another thing that makes it different from this era of these true Hollywood story type deals is that they wait for like a documentary. Like, there's a 7-hour documentary first, and then once they're like, well, most people know the documentary, so then we can do the shortened version of it in a dramatization. And that gives you more perspective, and like, you know, if you do it instantly, you're like, well, what are we reading a headline? Okay, let's just, you know, what did we hear instantly that happened to Joey Buttafuoco? Okay, great. And then let's just make the movie on it right now.
The Long Island Lolita.
That was the OJ FX show model.
Absolutely.
ESPN documentary came up first. And by the way, I love that American Crime Story season because it is trashy and full of kind of slightly past their prime celebrities.
Ryan Murphy knows what he's doing with that stuff. Oh, yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah. And that's the last time you'll ever see Cuba Gooding Jr. again.
Yeah. Well, I talked about him for other reasons why he hasn't been around so much at the top of the show. Yeah, exactly.
But, yeah, I mean, nothing but great things to say about this episode.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
This is the show getting itself. Like, this is them. I felt it a ton in Mr. Lisa Goes to Washington, even more in this. Like, this is just them going, like, this is a show now. We're free of having to have like a moral lesson at the end or like a big hug. We can parody TV shows and movies all we want. The animation is perfect. Like, Homer and everybody's becoming themselves, and they're understanding the wide swath of Springfieldians they can put in the series. Like, this is just so good.
Yeah. And I always forget it's at the beginning of season 3. In my mind, it's like, well, no, they figure things out more towards the end. But no, it's like from the very beginning of season 3, the show is becoming what we love.
So much.
And it was the first in the production run as well, wasn't it?
Second.
Only second. Wow. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So, which means that they hit the ground running. But yeah, I couldn't agree more with you, Henry. And it like we said during this episode, it surprised me how many, from hearing from you guys, how many things were just returning for the first time, like Willie and the kind of higher definition we get on certain characters. But it was great to go back and see, as also a Joe Mantegna fan, the first Fat Tony episode. I wouldn't have guessed this was his first either, and the only one he'd be in for several seasons as well. I was very happy to come back to specifically talk about this episode. Thanks.
Yeah, thanks for joining us, Brendan, for another very long episode. We're glad you enjoyed this one. Please let us know where to find you online and more about your podcast, Blowback, and perhaps when it will return.
Yes, of course. You can find me sometimes on Twitter at @deep_beige. You can also just follow at @blowbackpod. Is it Blowback Podcast or Blowback Pod? I don't know. You'll figure it out. But we have our season 3 coming this summer. I'm going to give us a little wiggle room and say this summer, definitely. Thinking July.
Awesome.
And it will be about the Korean War. If people don't know, our first two seasons are available everywhere. The first season is about the Iraq War, and the second season is about the war on Cuba. Specifically back in the 60s. We've got, you know, it's a narrative show, but we have bonus episodes with interviews. We have some cameos from performers and funny people that you might like as well. And we're excited to be going into this third season. So thanks for giving me a chance to shamelessly plug it.
No, yeah, Blowback is great. Me and Bob love it. You guys do such great like history stuff. And then on top of that, the side episodes, you know, that range from, you know, deep investigative like interviews with with other reporters or people on the ground in situations, or then just fun stuff with Bill Corbett or other comedians and just like goofing on movies, you know? It runs the gamut, and I love that about it.
Well, we love doing it, and I don't know how we found this little corner to do it in, but it's very nice, and you know, we're just trying to make sure we don't screw it up. this season will be good though, I'm pretty sure. So thanks again.
Awesome. Yeah. Can't wait to hear it.
Hey, your third season could be as good as the Simpsons third season. You know?
That's right. This was a good third season of something.
Yeah, exactly.
They really figured out Brendan in the third season of Blowback.
we really figured out the capital flight to the colonial territories, and really just made it the funniest character, you know, finally at that point.
but thank you so much, Brendan.
Thank you, Brendan.
Of course, anytime.
Thanks so much to Brendan James for being on the show. Please check out Blowback, an amazing podcast that we love. But as for us, if you want to check out more of what we do and get all these podcasts 1 week at a time and ad-free, please go to patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. Sign up for $5 a month. You get just that, but also everything behind the $5 paywall. That's over 100 bonus podcasts, but you also get access to monthly episodes of Talking of the Hill and Talking Futurama, our regular Patreon-exclusive monthly mini-series. That's all happening behind the $5 paywall at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons, and there is a $10 level as well. When you sign up for that, you get all the $5 stuff, of course, but also access to one huge, immensely long podcast once a month, only for patrons of that level or higher. And what is that, Henry?
Bob is talking about the What a Cartoon Movie podcast, where we do a deep dive into an animated feature film, just like we do on The Simpsons, each month, often for over 5 hours long at this point. We have covered recently, in April, we did Roger Rabbit, Who Framed Roger Rabbit, a classic that we have long feared doing because it's just so full of history, but we did a great job with that, I am assuming. Also, we, before that, did the Disney Golden Age classic, Pinocchio, and there's a giant back catalog of them, including, also this year, South Park, Bigger, Longer, and Uncut, which we had a ton of fun talking about. All of that, over 3 years worth of What a Cartoon Movies, I'd say over 230 hours of podcasts at this point, are available to you at that $10 level, in addition to all the $5 things Bob mentioned. It's a big, special premium podcast we do once a month that is totally worth your money, I dare say. Check it all out at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons.
So as for me, I've been one of your hosts, Bob Mackey. You can find me on Twitter as Bob Servo, and my other podcast, by the way, is Retronauts. That's a classic gaming podcast all about old video games. You can find that wherever you find podcasts, or go to patreon.com/retronauts. Sign up there for 2 full-length bonus episodes every month. And Henry, what about you?
Follow me on Twitter at @HENEREYG. I'm always tweeting up a storm there. And also, follow the official Twitter account of this podcast, @TalkSimpsonsPod. If you want to know when new episodes go out on the free feed on the Patreon, or if there's any news going on in our lives, follow @TalkSimpsonsPod on Twitter. And of course, you should always check out the official Talking Simpsons website, TalkingSimpsonsPodcast.com, to find a library of all of our previous released free episodes of Talking Simpsons.
Thanks so much for listening, folks. We'll see you again next time for Season 13's The Blunder Years, and we'll see you then.
This is something Bart would really have enjoyed, but it's the only way he'll learn.